at them and I talk with them, and I always say, when I go back and I meet with them, to tell them my decision, I always say, you know what, sometimes when
Good evening and welcome to the Georgetown School Committee meeting of Thursday, October 27th. If we could all please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, we're going to start off the meeting with our consent agenda. We have some minutes we need to approve, so I will make a motion to approve regular session minutes of October 13th, 2016, superintendent evaluation minutes of September 23rd, 2016, public relations minutes of September 23rd, 2016, budget finance minutes of October 3rd, 2016, and start school later minutes of October 17th, 2016, as well as acceptance of warrants 17V17 and 16P17.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Discussion?
Nope.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, we have a new student rep tonight. Hi, Gwen.
Hi.
How are you? Thanks for coming out in this rainy night. How's things going?
It's good.
Yeah. Good.
I don't think she quite knew exactly what her role was, so I talked to her a little bit. I put her on the spot if she didn't have a lot to say.
Yeah, that's okay. So yeah, we're winding down the first semester.
Yeah.
Right?
It
so that's over.
The fourth, I'm pretty sure.
Yes.
Okay. That's right.
Can you tell me when the homecoming is? Homecoming dance?
It's not a concrete date yet because there was a conflict, so we're trying to work that out right now.
Okay.
So it had something to do with the way the league has changed the games. So they used to have it on a home game, right? Remember? Mm-hmm. And there was some reason that couldn't happen. So I think it is being scheduled. Tender, do you know anything about that?
No.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. He's a class president. He might know something about it.
I just hope we don't not have it.
No, we will have
it. We will still have it, even if it...
And when Mr. Lucia comes, we'll ask him that, but we will have it. Okay. Absolutely, because I know I got a couple of emails about that. People were like,
we
canceled the homecoming. I know we didn't.
No, we have a couple of dates in mind. We just need to get it figured out and approved by everyone at the office. So we're working it out with Mr. Corbett.
Okay, good.
For sure.
So an important deadline tomorrow for seniors. Right,
yes,
they need to have
for
all the
yearbook.
Yes,
I'm home. I know about this. I'm the editor.
I knew you did.
Yeah.
So why don't we just remind people if they are listening that they need what?
So you need your senior picture in and your senior square, everything that you want to write, and your baby picture. That's stuff you need in. And then if you have any like throwback pictures, like group pictures from maybe like elementary school, we're asking for those too.
Okay, and you don't mind if they come in separate.
No, it doesn't matter,
as long as it gets in. So what time is the deadline?
It is.
Well, when you say October 28th.
Tomorrow.
Do you know why?
At 11:59.
Oh, okay. It does.
And if you don't, I'm going to find you. I'm going to talk to you.
PM. Not, okay.
11:59. Right. Is this electronic or is it all hard copy?
All you have to do is email it to georgetownyearbook2017@gmail.com. And then we put it in for you. It's super easy. All you have to do is send
it. It's not as easy, though, because our children...
Not for people who know.
...were before digital.
Oh, that's right.
So you have to scan the pictures, and I'm like, oh, my goodness, what am I getting? So it's not that easy.
Can you send them in? Can people send them in the hard copy, or does it have
you
to be scanned?
For your baby picture, you can bring it in, and we can scan it at the school, too. Uh-huh.
There you go.
See?
I took a picture of it. And then was able to.
I just didn't know if that would come out as good.
The resolution.
No, yeah, I did not.
No, it doesn't.
Yeah.
So if you still want to send
it
in
when I see
Scott's picture, you can do that.
Why am I blurry? Yeah.
Well, so the sports are winding down too. I know girls' soccer ended today, so pretty much all the sports are done and
the banquets will be happening.
Their senior games and all that. Yeah. So.
Well, that's good. It's an exciting time.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. Was there a cheering competition?
Yeah. I know that they won second.
Yes.
Oh, good.
But I'm pretty sure that the team that won first was like D1. Mm-hmm. So it's like really good that they won second.
Wow, that's great.
It was competitive.
I think we're
D3. Wow, that's great. Yeah. How did you know about that?
I think I saw it on Facebook.
Oh, that's nice. Good for them. Tracy does a great job.
Any teams make it to the playoffs?
She does, yes.
Football.
Football. For the first time since
Saturday?
2005, yeah. Wow. It was a long time.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah.
What's the first time?
Since 2000. Football.
So maybe we can replace that sign as you're entering Georgetown from Boxford that says home of the, you know, Georgetown Royal 2002. So maybe we could put it.
Yes, that'd be nice.
Oh, updated a little bit.
That would be very nice.
Very exciting. That's
it would be. Well, they have a game on Saturday.
Just to get so far is wonderful.
The football game Saturday in Malden.
Malden,
yeah. So good luck to them. But thank you for coming.
Oh, yes, anytime.
Yeah. Well,
now she knows what
don't
to expect.
Don't say that because we will be asking you. So throughout the evening, if we want to throw things at you, we won't put you on the spot. But it's nice to have the students' input.
Right.
Yeah, if you have any ideas about what we're talking about, feel free.
Right. Okay, is there anyone here from the public that would like to talk about anything on the agenda? Okay, we're going to begin the business with exciting news. We have the Superintendent Award winner here this evening.
We have him here and his parents and his brother. That was, you're a good sport to come along.
Why don't you come on up?
Come on up, Hender. You can just sit right at the table.
Brother?
Yeah, your brother can come with you too, of course.
You can have company.
You can bring him on
to steal the show.
Yeah.
Well, come on.
He would never join me.
So everyone, if you don't know, this is Hender Weiner.
Yes.
And I put some information, as I always do, in my orange notes about the person I choose. And it was really my great pleasure this year to choose Hender. You know, I tell the kids when I meet with them that it's really one of the most pleasurable decisions I get to make all year, but it's also one of the hardest because, as you can see, when you look at the information that the students and I do talk with the students about the information I put in the packet, and they're all very comfortable with you knowing. But partly the reason I do it is because I want you to see sort of the quality of the kids that I get to talk with. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, every kid at Georgetown is amazing, in my opinion, when I get to talk with them. But when I choose the Superintendent's Award, when I usually talk to the top, you know, five or six students in the class. So I learn a lot about their experiences in the school, what they would change, you know, what kind of ideas they have about what they like the best about it, but you know, also their career goals, and you know, it's just fun for me. Anytime that I can talk with young people, I consider that a pleasure. So after interviewing the top five students this year, as I said, who were all very, very impressive, I did select Hender for several reasons. I think mostly because I think Hender has a unique ability to be well balanced. You know, a lot of teenagers, it's a little hard sometimes to find that balance between all of the, you know, things that come up against you in life. And I think that I just really appreciate Hender's, you know, sort of well balanced approach to the way he thinks about life. You know, he's very conscientious. And on the one of the sheets that they fill out, I think they ask, what are three words that describe you? So I ask that interview question for every candidate that I interview, and they can never answer the question, but somehow the kids can. Mm-hmm. So one of the words Hender used was altruistic, and I think that is very, very fitting. You know, I think Hender has an amazing sense of purpose and an optimism. All you got to do is look at him. You can see he's got a very infectious, you know, positive smile, and you know, gauges you very quickly. I was very interested in talking to Hender to learn about his diverse interests and hobbies, you know, extending from travel. If you look at his information, you see he has had the ability to travel to different places, all different kinds of sports and outdoor activities, some of which he does competitively, some of them he does for fun. The music and the arts, clearly he's excels in those areas. And he talked about loving everything old, so that we have something in common. I love antiques. So that was really something I thought was really fun. And then just talking about, you know, kind of where he sees himself going, you know, just the idea that he, you know, has a sort of a passion for nonprofits and, you know, looking at ways that he can make the world a better place. And he has shown that by doing some of the things that you can see his hobbies include. You know, it's an academic award, so but I sort of treat it as an all-around award, but academics is definitely something that has to be a primary. And so clearly, Hender, he's fourth in the class, His GPA is 3.9, which is, you know, very impressive. He's taken a full load of honors, and even in his senior year, he's taking a couple of AP classes when he could be coasting. He's not choosing to do that. And he was a recipient of the President's Education Award for Outstanding Academic Excellence. And if you look on his sheet, you'll also see that he was selected as Student of the Year in several subjects, English, Spanish, Algebra 2, Wellness, Acting, and Business Marketing. And that's, of course, over the course of his high school career. He is a member of the National Honor Society. He was inducted in his junior year. And he is the president of the class of 2015. 17. Did I say 15? You should have graduated 2 years ago. 17.
Makes things a lot easier right now.
It might. Yeah, you'd be 2 years into college already.
Exactly.
So he is an active member. Do not wish away. Of DECA. He placed first in the stock market game for DECA, which is, I think, a very interesting. Shows a lot about your. I think Hunter has an entrepreneurial spirit that I found sort of. Different from what I in many kids that I meet, and I really loved that. And he is a tutor for younger students, and has a very strong work ethic and a selflessness that I think makes him someone that others can count on. I think anyone who knows Hender would refer to him as a leader, but maybe not the kind of leader who draws attention to himself all the time. I think he leads by including others and getting along with everybody, and he's a positive role model. He's not one for real self-promotion. Most of the time when we talked, it really wasn't about what he thought he did, but we talked about the things that he sort of does. I think the way he carries himself and the decisions he makes, I think show him to be someone who is, quite mature for his age, and I did find that to be impressive. And, his teachers have recognized him and his coaches and his peers by selecting him to leadership roles, like the captain of the basketball and the golf teams. He is a peer mentor. He's been the section leader for chorus. And according to Miss Donovan, he's quite an actor. I think Hender's one of those kids who's smart, but he doesn't always act like he's smart, right? I think that's an art. And I think he's kind and compassionate. And I really am impressed by Hender's positive can-do attitude. And as I said, I think he's got a smile that puts everybody at ease. I think one of the things that I thought was different about Hender is he's socially conscious and I think very civic-minded. He eagerly seeks out ways to improve the lives of others, and I think he really cares about the environment, and that was demonstrated recently. I think he's worked with one of his peers on a beach cleanup, and I think your daughter was involved in that as well, Suzanne. Saturdays are kids' time, and the fact that young people take their time to do things that will make their environment and their world a better place, is definitely noteworthy. And I think one of the things that's of particular note, and he can tell us a little bit more about it, because I'm not as tech savvy as obviously he is, but he founded a technology. Is that what it's called,
yeah.
Hender?
Spelled knowledge. Mm.
Yeah, not knowledge. Yeah, I got that part.
All right.
Where he collects old phones, and then he basically sells them.
Yeah, send them to an online company called Cellular Recycler, and they send the phones to either a third world country, or they recycle them, and they reuse the parts, and then I collect the money, and then the money goes into a scholarship fund for a student at the end of the year.
Right. So again, that's very entrepreneurial, I think, and a lot of students don't think to do those kind of things. So I think it really speaks.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
There you go.
Thank you.
So, that's in great shape too. Wow.
Not really.
Just might get some good money for that.
Yeah, finger. Seriously.
That might help.
Yeah.
But I think one of the things that I did right here that I think. That Hender doesn't always expect anything in return for the things he does, and I think he does things because he mostly believes they're the right thing to do. And I think that's really something that I felt when I talked with Hender. Hasn't quite decided what he wants to do with his life yet, but that's okay because lots of kids don't know that. But I think when we talked, he talked about wanting to sort of do something to combine his sort of entrepreneurial spirit with business, and then maybe his love for travel. So he might want to travel abroad someday. You know, he's, you applied to a couple of early decision schools, right,
Henry? Early action.
Yeah.
I don't want to bind myself anywhere just yet.
Right. So early action, and then during your regular application period, you're also.
Right.
Yeah, so he talked to me about Williams College and, you know, Villanova, Amherst College. I think your guidance counselor mentioned that you talked to her about. But I have complete confidence, honestly, that whatever he does, he's going to take full advantage of every opportunity wherever he chooses to go, and he's going to make a difference. The place is going to be better as a result of him being there. I think he's a very gregarious, special young man with a great head on his shoulders, and I'm confident that that he's going to make a difference, and he's going to be a catalyst for changing the lives of people for the better. So it does give me great pleasure to award Hender Weiner the Superintendent's Award this year. And so maybe Pam, you could take a little picture of us.
I'd love to. Yes. Yes.
There you go, Hender. Thank you. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for all you do.
Congratulations.
So here we go. We'll take a little picture. There we go.
One, two,
Take it sideways.
Wait a minute. Okay, cheesecake. All right.
Okay, sideways to heaven.
One, two, three. Chocolate cheesecake.
All right.
Okay.
So now we have to prepare your parents. I think you're more
Yeah.
The picture.
Let's get a photo bomb.
Thank you so much, and thank you for being here to support Hender.
I know. So Hender, sit down just for a couple of minutes.
I do have a question, though.
Yeah.
So I noticed that you, for 4 years in a row, you were the number one brother award.
Yeah. Oh, I put that in the, yeah.
How'd that come about?
I don't remember what the accomplishment was. I'm not really sure. Arlen got me a shirt probably... What was it, like last, it was probably like 2 years for Christmas, 2 years ago for Christmas, and it said, world's okayest brother. So I turned that into world's best brother.
I don't blame you. Well, I've had the pleasure of knowing Hender for a long time, and his parents, and his little brother and sister, and it does not surprise me that you are the young man that you are.
Thank you.
You have great role models, your grandparents are wonderful. I know that your sister's doing great.
Yep.
I'm sure you're going to do just as good. And then I'm waiting for Arlen to be sitting there in a couple of minutes. Right, Arlen? Right?
Yeah, big shoes to fill.
So what are the top schools that you're thinking of?
I think right now my number one is probably Middlebury in Vermont. We just all three of us checked that out, or all four of us looked at it. Probably last weekend or 2 weekends ago. Yeah, it is cold, but it's everything that I'm looking for.
Right.
Yeah, besides price and size.
yeah, that's okay. Things will all work out.
It all works out. It does.
That's great. But this is an exciting year.
Oh yeah.
Oh, for you.
Mm-hmm.
So I hope you take full advantage of that.
I'm sure
you will.
I'm doing my best. It's pretty stressful right now. Gwen can probably vouch for me on that also.
Yeah. Oh, it only... This is easy right now.
Well, it's not like you haven't taken on a lot of responsibility.
That's true.
Right? I mean, I think you have to give yourself credit. I mean, I think what you're doing... It took me 5 paragraphs to write about you.
It was very long. Yeah. I'm like, I don't remember a bit, but it was interesting because I thought I knew you pretty well. There are a lot of things in there that...
Yeah,
I didn't know. And
The superintendent went through a lot of information and consideration.
Yeah, and I wrote Hender a letter.
Yeah, I appreciate that, by the way.
It was a pleasure. It was a pleasure. Right. And his parents said it made him cry.
They what?
They said it made them cry. I said, well, did I get it right? They said, yes.
So that's important.
Yeah, actually, I of the 5 students, I wrote letters for 4. They asked me for them. So I was happy to do it.
Cool.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm always, I feel like, you know, they meet with me, they put themselves out there, you know, so, you know, I hate to disappoint anybody. I would have loved to give 5 awards out, honestly, and for reasons that you see I could have picked anybody. So it's always hard academically, they're all right around the same thing. So then I look at, well, what have they done for their school? And then sometimes I even have to go down to, well, what have they done for their community? Because they're just, they're all wonderful, amazing kids.
Yeah,
that are,
they were all very impressive. Yes. But I was with the superintendent right before she was meeting with you to give, and to the rest of the kids.
Yeah.
And I knew that you were very apprehensive about
it. It's hard,
like,
you know.
I'm going to have to
disappoint them.
Yeah. They're all gracious. And so I say, well, look, if there's anything I can do, I'm happy to write you a letter, you know, even if it's just for a job someday, you know, it doesn't hurt to have, you know, something in your back pocket. And they were like, oh, would you? And so
you get to know them.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's an honor
that's
for
of
all
nice,
of them, just anybody just to be considered for it.
Yeah.
You know,
well, that's one
honor.
Of the nice things about small school districts. And, you know, and I've been here 10 years, so I've had the pleasure of watching, you know, people grow and knowing families. And, you know, that really makes it a lot easier to be able to offer that and feel like I can confidently write, you know, about the students. So, but yes, it's been a pleasure. It's been a pleasure.
You're going to do great.
He's
going to
do great.
But we appreciate you guys coming out.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks for having us.
Yes. And how's your sister doing? She doing good?
Yeah, she's doing great.
Good.
We saw her last weekend.
Good.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah, she's enjoying it.
I miss seeing her around.
Yeah.
She FaceTimed us today at noon and she was sleeping, taking a nap.
Oh, she was taking a nap.
If you were in Georgetown, you'd be at school right
now. Yeah.
Math or bio class. Like, I know.
That's funny. Good for her, though.
I know. They do grow up.
Yeah.
They do. Well, thank you, Hendra, for being
thank
here.
You.
I know,
yeah.
Thank you.
For taking
congratulations.
Thanks.
You deserve it.
Thank you very much. Thanks for the phone, by the way. Going right to the fund.
There's just no SIM chip in there.
Oh, perfect.
Okay.
Not a problem.
All right. Bye-bye. Thank
you
again.
Bye.
Thank you again.
Bye, guys.
Fun.
I know, that's always nice. Okay, we have
so just the fire safety thing. I just want to give you an
update. Let's talk about that.
Yeah, so the family that they are going to come. They just couldn't come tonight.
Oh, okay.
So Laura, when what was the final?
We're working on the 17th.
Yeah, there because the mom can't come to the next meeting. So we want the whole family to be able to come. And you know, I participated in this wonderful ceremony that I did send a dual blog on. But you know, since the kids are part of our school community, I thought it might be nice for us to recognize them as well, and for you guys to have a chance to meet them. But they're really adorable young women, and they tell the story very well, you know. So I think we're just gonna have to delay this.
Okay.
But I just
is that November 17th?
Yeah. So
okay.
I wrote about it because we were anticipating it. So we'll have to table that.
Okay. And then we have the superintendent goals.
Yes. So I don't know if that format works for you, but I thought it might.
It does.
It might just be I could just add to it each time.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
No, I like that.
So we could go across.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
And that's kind of what we decided at the superintendent's evaluation, you know, subcommittee, and I think then we all agreed that we'd try this.
Yeah, I think it makes sense to do it this way.
It works for people.
Mm-hmm.
Let me just ask you, do you hold, so I know, you know, the monthly supervision meetings with each principal.
Yeah.
So has that been ongoing?
Yes, I've been doing that for years.
I thought so.
Yeah.
Okay, so.
Because the administrative team, you know, I mean, everybody's busy in their buildings, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, if the administrative team meeting goes all morning, right, then it is difficult for them to be in their building. So what we decided was we would have administrative team meetings from 9:30 to 11:00. Twice a month, and then I would go to the individual schools and do something very similar in the schools. The goal would be to, right now we've been, during our meeting times, we're talking about administrative goals, we're talking about the things that, you know, that schools are working on that I need to know about, and the goal would be to have the opportunity to do walkthroughs at the same time. But we end up with so much business to do that it's hard to get there. But I've scheduled those visits. Did I put the dates in here?
The dates are
Yeah. So that's kind of the only way I can do it is if I just schedule it, right? So sometimes the principals will walk with me and sometimes they won't, you know. Sometimes Jack will come with me maybe, or Colin. We talked about this at administrative team. So we could do sort of some instructional rounds where we could be looking for similar things. And if I wanted to go look at the special education programs, Jack might come along with me, you know, that kind of thing. So that's where, but if I schedule them, then they'll happen. If I say, oh, I think I'm going to get there Friday, and then Friday happens and I don't get there. So that's why we're doing it this way, and we'll see if this works.
Well, it seems to me when I looked at this that it's been a very busy time.
It is very busy. Mm. But it's all good, right? Mm-hmm. It's all important. And there's stuff on here that we're doing that's not represented. Right. I mean, there's other things we're doing that aren't represented. But but I think that what I was doing this, I said to myself, oh, this is great, because it is connecting, you know, to the things that, you know, the strategic plans connecting to these goals is connecting to the work that's going on at the school. So that makes it easier to respond to it. Because we'll make it more explicit this year, Michael, when we're doing a presentation, like, okay, this goes to one of the goals.
You know? I do feel that looking at this is going to really help us when we do the annual evaluation and seeing so what's been happening.
Well, it helps me too, because I'm like, oh my God, I need to do more of that, you know. So I think it's going to work out to be a good plan, I think.
Yeah, and this is, I like the visual because of how you can see the progress.
Right. Yeah. Right, because you sort of assess it based on some progress, significant progress. Isn't that how it goes? Right, don't you have to determine if it's not met that it's, so this I think will help.
It means there has to be progress, though.
There'll be progress.
Well, we're counting on that.
I shared these goals with the administrative team, too, because I said, you know what, we're all working on this together, right? You know, a lot of this work is stuff that we're doing with the school people. So, you know, I want people to know that we're all, you know, working together, and they're supporting me, and I'm supporting them. So,
Can I just ask for goal number 5, district improvement response to intervention?
Yep.
It sounds like there's a lot going on here with the iPads and the intervention materials.
Yes.
And I didn't know what it says, meant to discuss progress of rollout of PBIS.
Oh, PBIS.
Can you just tell me what PBIS is?
I've been hearing a lot about PBIS since our safety meeting.
Do you want to answer that question, because you're rolling it out. PBIS is,
we did talk about it. PBIS is the positive behavior intervention
system. Right, it's the behavior one.
Oh, that's important. Yeah. That's very important.
Well, it is, because it is a tiered model for social, emotional, and behavioral issues, the same way we have tiered interventions for academics. So it's the same, you know, universal, how we want every child to, behave in school and operate, and then what do we do for those children who have difficulty in that tier 2, and then that very small percentage of children who can't access the general curriculum. And responsive classroom is our general curriculum, but then we look at what else do we need to support students. It's working together as a community, a Pembroke community, to decide how do we want children to operate, what are the expectations for behavior, that we all agree to how it's going to look. So there's a lot to it. It's collecting data on behaviors the same way we collect it academically. So it's a very systematic way of
And the teachers are doing PD on that on November 8th.
And can I just ask, is that something that we've come up with, or is that based on some kind of theory, like collaborative problem solving out of
It is a mass fairly general broad, broadly used intervention system.
Yeah.
It's been around for a few years.
Okay. All right. Great. Thank you.
And it's designed strictly for elementary?
Nope.
Age?
Nope.
It can be a tiered, again, it can be a tiered, because really it's just a tiered model of support.
Right.
So, any school at any age, how we want children to behave, and again, social emotional curriculum, meeting, and then what you do for those few kids who have difficulty providing lunch bunch groups, or the advisory in many ways would be kind of that tier 2, and then for that very small percentage of students who have a great deal of difficulty, it's just providing more support for them.
Mm-hmm. So is that something that we are going to be
when we look at RTI, when we do the elementary special ed RTI, we can talk about this more.
Okay, sounds good. Thank you.
Okay, then next up we have the budget priorities. Thank you, everybody, for getting back to me with those. So there's a list in here of what...
this is what the email said.
Yeah. So pretty much revolving accounts, being healthy, utilizing iPads in the classroom, integrate technology into the daily instructional practice, maintain what we have, stop the cycle of having to remove any teachers, any staff. anybody that we need to keep as many people as we can. Mm-hmm. Support one-to-one technology at the middle high school. Restore health to revolver.
Mm-hmm. That's the same thing.
Which basically means getting salaries, moving salaries off of those revolving accounts.
Yeah,
right.
Suzanne, into that. That's where you come in.
Unless they belong there, right? Like preschool
unless
salaries.
Unless they belong there. Right, right.
New curriculum materials to meet new state science standards. Mm-hmm. Keeping our school facilities and field maintained in the manner that which we believe is acceptable. Middle high school textbooks and an athletic revolving account update, which, Michael, can you provide that? Like just a little bit of information on the athletic?
Maybe. No.
No.
Unless, not without a prompt.
Okay, right. Suzanne can prompt you.
Was that you? That was you, Pam, right?
No, Suzanne.
Oh, Suzanne wanted it. Okay.
Yeah, I just wanted to have a better understanding of it.
Oh, well, yeah.
So we, okay.
As part of the budget process,
yeah,
Suzanne?
Can,
okay, we can do that for sure.
Yeah, we looked at it.
Yeah, we looked at it in budget and finance meeting, but we didn't know that we were going to be asked about it. But we can bring in.
No. I think what Suzanne is saying is that as part of the budget process, that's a priority. She wants to understand that athletic revolving account.
Right. And then I'll ask more questions.
And then she'll ask the question.
Right. She wants how much of the budget assists with.
Right.
And things like that,
right,
that you would like information on.
What's actually in the revolving account and
charge to
it.
Right, and then, sort of where's it going out to and,
mm-hmm.
All the fundraising, where's that money going to?
Yeah.
And
Well, and all the revolving accounts are really important for us to understand and know what's going on with them because they're all, none of them aren't really terribly healthy.
Right.
So, and we, Michael, had asked to see those reports, see something, some kind of update, like, I don't know, every month or something. On the budget and finance mm-hmm. meetings, I mean, there's no reason why
it's periodic
we couldn't
updates
share so. That
yeah.
With the committee, and maybe we could report on that as part of our, telling the committee about what's happening with the budget and finance.
So right now, you guys are meeting every 2 weeks.
Every other week.
Every
yes.
other week. Okay.
Yeah.
We're meeting on Monday.
Yeah, but we did all we did agree to, that we wanted to know more about what's happening with the revolving accounts
mm-hmm.
because they are in such a fragile state.
We have a section in the book, but if it's not something that you're, it's a spreadsheet with teeny tiny numbers. So unless you understood the backstory to it, I can see why you'd have questions about it.
And that tells you at one point in time, and this is the budget
yeah.
going forward. It doesn't
yeah.
tell you like on
no, that's right.
Updated
yeah.
basis.
Right.
Have you ever been on budget and finance?
No.
Now's your chance.
No.
I can't even balance a checkbook. Are you kidding me?
Maybe next year.
I don't even have a checkbook
really
to balance.
Interesting.
You don't have to
lot.
Balance a checkbook.
It's
she does. You just have to come
like
to meetings.
I just write checks. I could care less what's in there. You want me on budget and finance?
I'm not going to be possessive
no,
about
I didn't
a seat,
I didn't
Suzanne.
Know.
If somebody,
No, I'm just saying.
I'm on it this year.
I like governance.
You make rules, not.
I know. I like to make the rules. I'm just kidding. I'll try budget sometime.
Don't we all?
Okay. So, again, I appreciate all the time that you guys put into providing that because they are all very important, and I know these are things that you'll be sharing with the administrative team.
Definitely.
Too.
And we talked about it on Tuesday as well in terms of what the administrative priorities are as well, so and very consistent with.
I was going to say I would
yeah.
love to see what those priorities
yeah.
are, but I'm sure they're.
Well, we'll make
with.
Sure we talk about that when we. But yeah, they are consistent. I mean, obviously we don't want to maintain. I mean, some of the things we talked about were things that we really needed to advocate to add, so that we could really, and we are talking about like the accreditation. We have to make sure that we're
mm-hmm.
ready for that, and that includes a budgetary, cost as well. That's going to have to go into the budget. For a spring visit, so.
How often does that occur?
Well, they say it's a 10-year visit,
mm-hmm.
but we haven't had one since 2006. So yeah, so they're coming in 18.
Okay.
Where we were today, it was.
Yeah.
They were
I
put
know
off
Peter
beyond
that.
18 to unknown.
Yeah.
Seemingly indefinitely.
Yeah,
because
Peter mentioned that. Well, that's actually would be something worth a conversation because
yeah.
in the budget cycle that we're facing potentially. Finding $20,000 to $25,000 isn't going to be easy. If there's a way to maybe
push it out a year,
push it out a year, to that might be worth
talking.
No, but you wonder if in a year or two it's going to be any better.
But does that hurt? Does that hurt the school any if you keep pushing out?
No, because you are accredited, right?
So you have that.
We are. It's fully accredited. The only thing that would be worth it maybe for us is we're fully accredited, but we're on warning for community resources for learning. We want to get off of that,
right?
But we do have to be careful because obviously the reason we got on it the first time was because there were issues with the budget and they didn't see a maintenance of effort. And so, you know, when they come is kind of important because if we cut things from the budget last year at the high school, if we cut again this year, then, you know, we might be in the situation where, you know, having them come just means we're going to be staying on warning.
And if we cut their budget out of the...
I know. Right? Then we'll all be fine.
Yeah.
We just come back. We might want to use their budget somewhere else.
But we did so well with all the other points that we needed to address.
We did. We are going to have... If they came today, this year, I don't think there would be any issue. But I don't know what happens if the budget continues to be, you know, a challenge.
And they agree that we're doing well on the other six standards.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, absolutely. That's and there were a lot of commendations even in standard 7. But they were concerned about the lack of a long-term maintenance plan. They were concerned about a long-term technology replacement. Well, actually, technology plan in it. Anyway, there was nothing but refurbished computers then. I mean, now they'd be very impressed if they came in and saw if the same team came and looked again. They were very concerned about the budget, the allocation of the budget. What was interesting is a lot of times they told us that if you're on standard 7, if you're on warning for standard 7, you're usually on warning for curriculum because usually but that wasn't the case. So it really, and they remember they were worried about overcrowding. There were issues with the building,
right,
and then they were waiting till Pembroke opened because we moved sixth grade. So as I said, I think when I look back at the things that they cited, you know, that particular team, it's obviously a different team that comes, I would say that they would give us credit for making the progress that we've made. However, you know, we just want to make sure we don't go in that direction again. But we are fully accredited, so it's not like people have to worry about that. But so I think that's a discussion, whether or not we want to approach them and say, hey, are you interested? But as Barbie said, there's no guarantee 2 years out. That's why when the budget analyst work is done and whoever sits together and says, all right, what are we going to do now?
Mm-hmm.
You know, depending on what the action plan looks like, then, you know, maybe there is a particular year that's better for us.
So when will you be just giving us an update on that
budget analyst?
Yeah.
Well, today, Mark Abrams and his son, Matt, who are the people that were contracted by the town from the Abrams Group, met with the treasurer and the accountant, Suzanne, myself, and Mike Farrell.
Mm-hmm.
And basically they produced three spreadsheets that they're still working on. One is a capital plan, and these went from 2000, they looked at 13 to 23. Well, they didn't look at 23,
so
but they budgeted out to 23.
Actually been contracted.
Yes. Oh, yeah, they're doing the work. So they have there's a plan for capital for 10 years out. There's a plan, they had a document that was for revenue and a document for expenses. And, you know, obviously there are some assumptions you have to make, and there are also, they base it on actuals. But then, you know, 10 years out, you don't know what's going to be happening 10 years out. But, like, for example, if you're projecting health insurance, they look at the average of what the last 5 years have been, right? And then they do this thing they call a factor, where they say, all right, what can we figure for every year going out that health insurance might be? So let's say they say 7%. So every year to the projection, they apply 7% increase. So it might be less than that, might be more than
It'll probably be more.
Might be. And so we did have to, one of the adjustments that we did talk about today is on the school side in the projections, they had said, you know, for personnel, the factor could be 1.5%. And I said, no, because our increases are higher than 1.5%. The average of the last 5 years was 2.4% overall. That's the average. So some were higher, some were lower. So I said, you can't budget 1.5. It's not a real number. It's going to be bigger than that. So that was one thing they were going to make an adjustment to that. But one of the things that was very interesting to me was the capital, right? Because if you look at everything on the capital list, you know, maybe it's $10 million, right? So divide that up and say $1 million a year. Well, the town right now has been spending $0 to $50,000 to maybe $100,000 in capital, right? So there's a quite a delta there, right? So that's the kind of stuff that I think the reports are going to show. And then like the OPEB contribution, which is something that the town really wants to do, they're tracking that and they're seeing that there's not much, there's a fund, but not much in the fund. So they're projecting out, like if you don't put anything in the fund, what's gonna happen 10 years out? The thing I'm worried about is it's gonna be a forecast and they're gonna do a report. So they are trying to get a draft of the report now that they got more information today, draft within a couple weeks. That's gonna come out the first draft. People are gonna have a chance to look at it for accuracy. And then the final report they're hoping is going to be out in early December. And then that's kind of they're done.
And are you going to have a chance to look at it for accuracy?
Yep.
Okay. The problem, so all department heads.
I'm not sure because I asked Mike what the rollout was. And he didn't really have that fleshed out yet. Mm-hmm. But that was the timeline that the group gave. And then what worries me, though, is that... So that's the forecast. But now the forecast is not any good unless you get the right people in the room to say, all right, what does this tell us now, right? So now what do we do about this? And I'm thinking like the strategic planning group that I'm working with the town and others are in the town, are if that those two things come together, that'll make a lot of sense. If they don't come together, I don't know what happens. So it's like any other plan, right? It's a bunch of numbers on a page and going to tell a certain story, but the town has to figure out like, okay, what's the next step in the story, right? What's going to happen as a result of it?
So then once the final report is given in December, then
I think what the plan will be is like all the boards will need to get together, right, and have a conversation about that. I think I said, well, if it comes in December, then it could inform the budget for FY18,
right?
If it comes in February, all bets are off. But they thought that it would be done in December. Then I think we talked about having a tri-board meeting or something. I mean, I think the town's got to then pull everybody together and say, okay, what does this look like for the FY18 budget? Right?
Yeah.
What are we looking at? And then what does it mean the next 2 years, you know, because now, you know, this is what the projection looks like the next couple of years out, that long-term budgeting that we've been talking about and wanting to do. So I think the town is, it's great they spent the money. It's going to help a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But it's the devil's in the details as to what's going to happen with it, mm-hmm. you know, and what's the capacity of the town to come up with some kind of strategy that may be a little painful.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Right. So that's where we are with that. But it was worth it. I would have liked to go to the one-to-one visit today to Hamilton Wenham, but it wasn't important to, you know, be there for that meeting as well.
Definitely. Definitely.
Okay. Thank you for that.
You're welcome.
Okay. We don't have school reports.
No school reports.
Okay. Can I just ask one thing about the budget priorities? Do we know yet how much the new curriculum materials to meet the state science standards?
We do not. Colin's still working with the science team on that. I mean, we talked, the number we were, and again, I hate to even throw it out because it was $15,000 or $20,000.
Okay.
But it depends, you know, again, like if you buy the text, what are the support materials cost? Sometimes they throw kits in, you know.
Right.
So I don't know exactly. But that is on one of our, the next meeting, we're going to put in the packet the school committee topics.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's one meeting where their science vertical team is going to come and he's going to discuss the elementary curriculum request and what the recommendation is, because that'll give him several months to work with his team. So they're piloting a couple of things. They did some piloting last year. They kind of know like what curriculum they're favoring, but that'll give them time to sort of work out some of the bugs and be able to come. So we'll do that in coordination.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Okay. All right, we want to talk a little bit about the cap and gown changes.
Sure.
Senior memo. So if there's questions about anything else that's in this memo that Peter put together, we can answer those too.
Peter, do you want to come on up?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah. No,
definitely. seems like the senior class is keeping you busy.
Very busy. They're very creative this
hair,
year.
They might give him a gray one.
Yeah. There's hair up there, you know. So, they are have some new ideas, and you know, I applaud them.
I
that.
Also do. Yeah.
And we just want to make sure that, you know, everyone can afford their ideas, and that they're something that is in line with our mission statement and what we do and things like that. So I'll start with...
Can we start with the prom?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's what I was going to do.
Yeah, good. Let's start with the prom.
We're going to get to the cap and gowns last.
Sure.
So the prom, they had a couple ideas, and they wanted to go on a boat in Boston, and I told them if we're going to do that, if we're going to, you know, be outside a reasonable driving radius, that we're going to do what most schools do and take a bus. And so we got very close with the boat because, well, I wanted them to ask everybody. And it's just not the senior's decision because it's a junior-senior prom here. So the big thing with taking a bus is that it is not unusual for kids to leave, you know, after about, you know, 9, 10 o'clock, and you won't be able to do that if you take a bus. Everybody comes together, everybody leaves together. So I wanted to make sure everybody was good with that. So we got really close, and then I found out that we were sharing the boat with two other schools, and that's just not a good idea. So we didn't have a place that was just ours, and so we went to Plan B, and they had a couple other ideas, and we wound up with Willowdale Estates. So the first thing I wanted to make sure is, it was it suitable to have a prom? So Mr. Prescott and I visited the place, and personally, I think it's going to be a tight squeeze. It's outside under a tent, and it looks pretty tight to me. Yeah. Yep.
Bradley Palmer State Park.
Yeah,
right?
It's in there.
I remember walking around that building before they had done, when it was really still ruins.
Yeah.
And I looked at this place on Google. Did you Google it?
No.
And it's gorgeous. It's so elegant and exciting.
It's in Topsfield, but it's,
yeah, it doesn't. I didn't see like the floor
it's
plan
the
or how.
It's
no, like, I think it's really on the. It's really
I think
close
it's on
to
the
Ipswich.
Oh, Ipswich.
Yeah, and the Ipswich River's in the back.
Yeah, it's not
so
hard
it's
to get
down by the Ipswich Country Club on that road?
It is.
No, it's off that road.
Okay.
It's very close to...
Waiting pool, yes.
It's near Pingree.
Well, it's on the way to Pingree.
It's very close to Turner Hill Country Club.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's just before.
Yeah.
So if it's under under a tent, then what's the problem with capacity? So
it's
I can't picture
because
the tent sides down.
The sides.
Okay.
It's, you know, this would.
And I have heaters, right, in the tents.
Yeah, the heaters.
Okay,
yeah.
So I don't want the girls to freeze.
Yeah, and it's a cement platform.
I don't want anyone to freeze.
Well,
believe me, I grilled them long and hard about all of these things, and I, you know, it's.
It's something different.
It's nice. It really is nice. But I said, you have to plan on almost every prom that we go to. It's cold. You know, May 15th or around there. And you have to plan on, you know, being inside that tent with the sides down. And
can they go into the building at all?
Just to the bathroom.
Oh.
Yeah. Okay. The building's not set up. The building has a very small function room.
Okay.
Or function rooms. So when they do big functions, and they say they do them from May to October, they're out there under the tent.
Right.
And they really...
How many kids do we have that go to the junior and senior prom?
It's a lot.
Well, we're working on the number 250.
Because we usually have pretty close to 100%
we
participation.
We get a lot of participation,
right.
Yes.
Plus, people bring guests.
Yeah. Right.
So I think it's going to be a tight squeeze. I do. There's a patio before you go into the tent where it would be a place where you would socialize and things like that. But if it's raining, then there's a...
Well, let's hope for a beautiful day.
Yeah, we want a beautiful night. And
the cost was...
a lot.
I just don't want anyone to be deterred because of it, because it is quite significant.
Yeah.
We're looking at $100 versus $45, which...
Yeah, so what I told them when I found out what the cost was, I said, you need to ask everybody, because you can't make this decision for them when it involves this kind of money. So we did a survey, and most of the kids picked that. So that's where we're going.
I was thinking the same.
Yeah. Like, how many of those kids are paying for it?
Yeah, but it's going to be, it's more than just that ticket, because really, no one has taken limousines in a long time around here, because it was at the Georgetown Club. Right. So I'm sure they're all going to take that. And that's
okay, so that was my next question then. So the transportation is strictly going to be up to the individual?
Yeah, I think it's close student. Enough. It's like 11 miles or something like that. Mm-hmm. So they'll be on their own to go there. And, you know, I think kids usually, you know, we've gone to proms much further than that. Mm-hmm. But so I'm not worried about that.
We used to go to Danvers pretty
regularly. We've been to Danvers. Right? We've been to some places in New Hampshire. Spinelli's.
I remember Spinelli's. Mike did Spinelli's. He was the advisor.
Yeah, that was Mike's prom.
Yeah. That was a great prom.
I think it's a great idea to change it up. But Black Swan is a beautiful facility, and they've been very good to us. I think it's time to
but you maybe appreciate them more when you
I'm just nervous of a tent, though. I mean, if it's pouring out, that's miserable.
You know, let's hope not.
No, I know you can hope not, but
I went to a wedding that was in a tent, and I was very worried about, you know, how cold people were going to be and how cold I was going to be and all that. And it did rain, sort of. It was, you know, but they had the heaters in the tent. Mm-hmm. Really did a lot for everybody. I was very comfortable, and everybody was. So,
well, the bottom line is the kids are going to have a good time no matter what.
That's
right.
Yes. Yeah.
Right. No, just the advisors are going to freeze.
I always go. I'll wear my warm.
No, that's good. Okay. Yeah.
So that was a little novel. And
I love the idea about the yearbooks.
Yeah. So one of the editors came to me.
That was me.
And asked me about what I thought about them having their yearbooks in the summertime, which is very different than we've ever done. And the reason is because the yearbooks that we give pretty much end in the winter. Right. With
you don't get senior proms, there's not spring, even any sports, spring. No graduation, none of that.
Yeah. And a lot of schools do supplements.
Yes.
But we haven't even done that.
Supplements would be more expensive than shipping. Mm-hmm. So
now the only thing you'd well be lacking.
Prepared.
The only thing you'd be lacking is, you know, signing.
That's the only
thing.
Well,
there's a day that we want to do. We want to have, like, a picnic day sometime in August everybody comes back on a certain day.
Oh, good idea.
Sign them.
I also heard maybe giving, like, the kids something, like a
yeah, there's also at the banquet, we could give out papers that everybody signs at the banquet, and then we can put it
just insert them
later.
Oh,
yeah.
Idea.
Mm-hmm.
And I also brought up that we'd like to see them come back for homecoming, so they could do something there. Maybe set up a little tent.
the
calf.
Keeping with the theme.
Yep. Mm-hmm. So those were all ideas, but again, that's something very different, and it really makes the senior banquet something very different, because most of what goes on at the senior banquet is the signing of the yearbooks. So the class decided that they wanted to do that.
But if you do the little insert thing, that would be great, because that's
a good idea.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I think that's a great idea.
So then what will you do at the banquet?
Well,
you'll still have it.
We don't know where it is yet, so that kind of determines what you can do.
Well, you do the slide. Usually you have
We do a slideshow. Class, they have a problem with the time capsules, too.
Oh, right. Yeah. Time debacle. Capsules, no, well, they won't.
What's the problem with the time capsules?
All of our time capsules burned down.
That's when that house burned, when the
fire.
Barn burned down.
That's right.
I know, and I can't believe we didn't. We tried. I know a group of parents did try to
resurrect them.
When that happened, to get new time capsules, but that's
maybe
a bummer.
We could think about how we could do something. Because that is a nice tradition.
Yeah. Well, I mean, big picture.
It is what it is, right?
No one was hurt. So
no one
okay.
was hurt. Yeah. You're right. You're right. That's the right way to think about
yeah,
it.
That poor
right.
family.
Unless you do a new time capsule in your 10-year high school reunion.
There you go. Good yeah. idea, Suzanne.
Yep, that's a good one.
But now the other grades will also be receiving the yearbook later?
Not necessarily.
Not necessarily, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, why? How so, would that be then?
Well, I think that's something that would be up to each class.
No, but like
but
if I purchase like a separate yearbook like for my 10th grader.
Yeah.
It'll be mailed to you.
So it's the same? So all the yearbooks would go out in the summer?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can't send out two different
yeah, right.
yearbooks.
Okay. That's what you're
so it's the same yearbook.
Yeah, the yearbook isn't just a senior yearbook. It's everybody.
Yes.
Everybody's in it. We make sure that everybody's in it at least like twice or three times.
So we might want to think about how to give the other grades a chance to sign, to you know, get their own piece of paper to have everybody
sign.
Well,
I don't think we've ever done that.
Yeah, that's not such a thing with the underclassmen.
They don't sign.
But I'm glad you mentioned that because I did want to do a little sales pitch right now while we're talking about it because a lot of people don't know that, and I think that's pretty unique for our school. That it isn't a senior yearbook. That, well, it is and it isn't, but it's predominantly for seniors. But all of the classes are in there, and not just like a team photo. It's in the individual pictures of each kid are in there. And
we're trying really hard this year to make it different than past years, and we're doing a lot of different formats and giving more people, like, more shout-outs almost. Like, for clubs, we're, like, having pictures of the officers, and sports, we're having, like, captain's pictures and all this stuff and more writing. So I feel like more people will want to buy it if they're in it more and there's more actual like writing about what they did.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've always bought one each year since my kids entered the high school. But it is quite it's a significant difference from the Pembroke yearbook to the middle high school.
Right,
and then
right.
all of a sudden it's like $70 versus
yeah. Oh,
12.
Yeah.
Right.
But it's
well, we have
well
a middle school yearbook too, and that
and that was yes. cheap. That was really
yeah,
cheap.
Yeah, it's about $15 or somewhere around there. So
yeah,
you get the bound.
So
but,
I
yeah, but this is
so
hot.
This is like no, it is. It's beautiful.
I love the way the seniors do their little profiles, though.
Yeah.
I think
so.
That
is the
nice.
Oh the squares?
Squares.
Yeah.
Is the committee predominantly seniors? Is
in yearbook?
Yes.
We have seniors and juniors and I think three sophomores, which is pretty good. We've actually this is one of the bigger. Like turnouts that we've had, but we're doing a lot of different stuff this year and a lot more like writing and everybody has a lot more jobs than before. It's very organized.
Good. Who's the yearbook? Who is the teacher that helps?
Mrs. Dodge is the advisor, and then me and Megan Fogarty are editors.
Yeah,
great. Oh, good. I commend you for that change because I think
it is huge
because you know, when it ends in winter, all of a sudden it's like there's so many all the fun things happen.
Right, like graduation,
after.
Spring sports.
Right.
Our senior prom, like that's pretty, especially if we're having it in a new spot, like we want that.
Right.
Yeah, sure.
So whether we're talking about activities, the question came up before came about homecoming. When is homecoming? The homecoming dance.
We still don't know. I think I set a tentative date. 18. I want to say November 18th.
Yeah, that's the date that.
Is that a Friday?
Yeah, that's the date that I had, but.
Yeah, well, we don't know that we're going to have a home game there. So this new football, we may not have any more home games. So if we don't, it's going to be on that date.
On the 18th.
Yep. And I don't know why the senior class didn't want it on the last home game that we had in October.
It was too early, they said, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Wasn't that the problem?
Well, I think we didn't. The football schedule didn't come out, and we didn't know when the last home game was going to be.
Got it.
So we were kind of waiting on the football team and just waiting for them to give it to us, and then they never did. So we were like, okay, we're going to just have it kind of at the 18th because we can't really wait for other people to set this date for everybody.
Right.
So we wanted to do that, but then we really want to have it on the date with the home game, and it was just...
Yeah, didn't have enough time to get it done.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a challenge with the new playoff system.
Yeah. Mm.
Because it's week to week. We don't know who we're playing next week. We know we're playing somebody. It depends if we win or lose.
Right.
And we don't know if it's... We have a more... it's more likely that if we lose, we will have a home game.
Oh.
So...
I know, you would
usually
think
we wouldn't have home
because we're a lower seed than most of the people in the bracket.
Oh, so our next game is gonna be away then, because
yes, we want all away games.
Positive.
We want all away games.
So is the homecoming dance traditionally a time when graduates come back?
Yes.
And, you know, so we reach out to alums or maybe just through,
yeah, traditionally, but I would say that there aren't a lot of graduates that come to that. It's right. It's still,
because they're in college.
And they would come for the
football game. Yeah, it's a high school
too,
game. Right? Yeah. Graduates pour in for Thanksgiving.
That's, right. That makes sense. Yeah, yeah, sure.
That's when they really come. It's more of a senior thing and a high school thing.
But graduates are welcome.
Yeah, and if we have a little yearbook signing thing there, it's a way to attract more.
Yes, yes.
In the future, so.
That's right.
So it should be called something else other than homecoming.
Well.
Or make homecoming Thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so on to the.
Before.
So the cap and guns. That's kind of a long story that started last year, somewhere around this time, when the committee asked me, you know, what if we're looking into that, and I think you, Pam, that yes, I would look into that. And so between that and the senior class officers approaching me about a gender neutral gown, I started some research, and I looked to some area schools and what they do. And I heard back from 14 of them, and 11 have gender neutral gowns. And while I was going back and forth with my colleagues, an advisory was mentioned that came from DESE a while ago about the new gender law that came about in 2012. And there is a paragraph in there, which I believe that you have,
mm-hmm.
that tells us how these advisories, every time there's a new law that has a major impact on schools, DESE usually sends out an advisory on how we should be implementing this law and things like that. And so it specifically says that we should, you know, move away from practices like having gender-specific gowns and things like that. So as I was starting to move forward with that, I heard from a couple students that wished that that's not what we were going to do. So I asked them to speak to their class officers, which they did, and so in collaboration with everybody, we're really looking at this and what we want to do. And I'm going to talk to, I did put a survey out to the seniors about some options for them that were all gender neutral. And I did that because I see this at this point as a compliance issue.
Mm-hmm.
And I also see it as something very consistent with what we stand for, what our mission statement stands for and our beliefs, with what our social expectation stands for. And it's in line with the strategic plan, which is always a guide for us when we do a school improvement plan and have a major goal about acceptance. And it all fits in very nicely. So I haven't made any final decisions yet. I still want to talk it over with the seniors. I want to hear from some parents. But I would tell you that I'm leaning very strongly to doing that this year.
Good.
Yeah.
I want to thank you for taking my emails over the last couple of days and the superintendent.
We're happy to.
I am, we've talked, you know, about how I feel, and it's more so, I just want to engage the students and the community, because I do think the community needs to be engaged in this. And the reason why I say that is because as I've been researching it over the last week or so,
it seems that the districts that have had trouble making that change, it was because of the way they did it. It was because, you know, the community felt like it was done, you know, behind closed doors, and that no one really knew what was going on. And I can tell you that a lot of people that I talk to don't know that this has come up. Mm-hmm. So when you say that, you know, oh, well, let's hope that the kids are telling their parents. Mm-hmm. I know mine didn't.
Yeah.
I have a senior. You know, I didn't hear. It just wasn't important.
Well, we're not really at that stage yet, you know. So I do want to hear from parents, and I want to talk to the senior class. I've heard from some seniors, and, you know, from both sides of the story. So I don't think we're there yet, Barbie, to tell you the truth. So
right.
when I do make a decision, well, even before, I'm going to, you know, tell them what we're thinking of. I'm going to tell them what I just told you. And, you know, when I hear from the kids, I want to tell them, you know, these are the reasons why I think we should. I hear one reason why we shouldn't, and am I missing anything? Tell me more. And same thing with the parents, and then, you know, we'll make that decision. But
well, I'm most appreciative of the fact that we're even having the conversation here, because I know this is your decision. It's not a policy. It's not anything that the school committee can say, you know, yes or no to, which is fine by me. I'm just saying, as far as, you know, being a parent, not just because I'm a parent of a senior, but I'm thinking too that the underclassmen should be involved too. So that's, and I'm just, as far as gender neutral, I think that that's great, but the option of having two colors could still be a viable option if
I didn't think it out. So when I did the initial survey, it was the senior officers picked out this blue gown with a white accent.
I put that in here for
saw,
you.
Yeah, but it's not colored.
And,
yeah, it's
not colored.
And
yeah.
One
it's
of the schools...
Like I went online and saw it.
Okay. Yeah. So one of the schools that I talked to, they used two colors and alternated alphabetically, so every mm-hmm. other.
So it wasn't boy-girl.
Right.
So I thought, well, I'll put that out there for an option. And then some people that brought it to my attention that, you know, we do this now. We're a little behind, so we're really going to get going on this. And unfortunately, there are some kids that don't make it, that are borderline, and they don't make it. And when that doesn't happen, it's going to throw off the scheme tremendously.
But would that be...
You know what I mean? So you'd have two whites, you have two
white. Because you can't swap off robes.
If somebody was sick, I mean, would people
last year we
know?
Had one child that didn't attend graduation, but I mean, would that be really a huge deal?
If we swapped everything.
But what about if you just said to the kids, what color do you want to wear? Blue or white? You know, to everybody.
Yeah.
That's an option that districts have put out there.
Okay.
And it's worked.
They have that option. They have had that option. That option exists.
What in this?
I've had people wear a different color.
Right. Okay.
And I think that puts them in a very difficult position.
Yes.
And I don't want that in my school. I want to place an environment where everyone doesn't have to worry about things like that, and that everyone is the same. Everyone is equal. So. You know, we haven't got there yet exactly what we're going to wear, but most schools have a color. We have one color. Our colors are not blue and white. It's royal blue. That's our color. And we have an accent color, which is white. And most schools, that's what they do. So when you go to college, there's one color.
Just one color. Mm-hmm.
Yep. The faculty wears one color. Well, you wear one color.
Mm-hmm.
I just want to say that there are some people that don't identify with any gender,
mm-hmm.
so
mm-hmm.
that would be kind of an issue. Is like, oh, just pick a color. They could just be like, well, I don't identify with either color.
That's an
so
excellent
where would,
point.
So where would I go? You know what I mean? So it's like if everybody has the same, I feel like those kids don't need to worry about it.
That's an excellent point, thank you.
Because the colors already have kind of a gender meaning attached to them, unless you do the every other, unless you did, you know, something else.
But then the question is, what's the driver? Is it the fact that there's two colors? I guess I'm not sure why that's a,
and then
an option that people would be more inclined to, if it, I get the white and blue girl and boy thing. If people want to keep it the same, I get that. But if it's white and blue, ABC order, so like, a boy could be wearing white and another boy could be wearing blue. I'm trying to understand how that's more palatable than a blue gown with white accents that everybody can identify with. That's why I'm struggling with that choice. Like, what would make somebody make that choice? What would be they be thinking? I don't know. That's why I think it's good to ask, right? Like, why would that be? So if that's an option, why would that be an option? And what are the pros and cons to it? That's the conversation I think Peter wants to have with the kids, is this is what we're thinking. Help me think about what are the pros and cons. What am I maybe missing? And hopefully the students will speak up.
Yeah.
I think the tricky thing about alternating alphabetical is the tradition has been girls were white and boys were in blue. And then now you're changing the idea, but people might, still not feel that.
Might feel funny if they were in a color that they're not comfortable with.
Or even folks watching might not understand it, even though it's communicated.
Mm-hmm.
So when do you have to order them?
Pretty soon.
Right. So when you say you're not there yet, that's what I mean. Like,
well,
when are you going to be
I'm
there?
On it. next week, I have a lot of balls in the air right now, so I'm trying to.
I mean, the only thing I would think, just aesthetically, it's just kind of nice to have the two colors aesthetically, which is why it's important to pick the right design. You know, I mean, I like in terms of everybody feeling comfortable. Like, you know, personally, I think it's easier if they're all one, but the design has to be right.
And it's very hard. I don't have to tell anybody in this room. It's hard to make everyone happy. Remember the G discussion that we had about the font?
Not our decision. Good luck with it.
We didn't make a decision on the G. That's correct.
Well, the students will have a big input into that. But
yes.
So while I'm here, just a point of clarification, because you were talking about NEASC a little bit in the cost. It's more like 30, 35.
Oh, instead of 25?
Yeah, yeah.
Thanks for clarifying.
Yeah.
I know I was talking to somebody recently that's in a vocational school that's preparing, Whittier. Whittier's preparing for a visit soon, and I think they had to put 40 in their budget, but because vocational is a little different because they have all the different shops, there are more people that come.
Yeah, all that money is, you have to put people up in a hotel and you have to feed them, and it's expensive.
Well, we don't have to put them up in Newburyport.
That's correct.
No.
Where are you going to
put them up? I think we put them up in Danvers last night.
The country.
Can't you do like an exchange student, like ask the parents, hey, can you just take
Yeah, we can have host families.
That's a thought. Now you're thinking outside the box, Barbie.
That's right. Yeah. Volunteer.
I mean, not that I would. Barbie's idea is a host family thing.
Yeah.
Well, that might be very interesting, but you can't speak to them, right? You can't tell them.
But they work. They work as a group until midnight. They don't get a lot of sleep.
They give them snacks.
I've been on one of those committees.
Lots of food.
There are a lot of work.
So how do I get on one of those committees?
It's intense.
So Peter, so you're planning to talk with the students and you're planning to find some kind of a way to give parents an opportunity to speak
with
them.
In the next week or two, yeah.
Okay, so that's the answer to your question. I don't think we answered it. So before Thanksgiving.
Absolutely.
Well, if I didn't get an email from him, I would have emailed him. He knows.
Yeah.
I think he's afraid when he sees my emails now. He's like, oh, no.
No, I don't think so.
No? How many students are in the class?
Sometimes when I hit send, I'm like...
Well, you know what? Just call me and say, I'll take that one back. And I'll just delete it.
Don't open it.
Text him. Don't open it.
Yeah.
I had a few of those too, you know.
To me?
No.
No. We've all probably sent emails that were like, you know, you're just a little, you want to proof them. You always want to proof them.
Yeah.
Yeah, but like, or wait 24 hours.
Or wait 24 hours.
Sometimes it's better to talk.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I agree.
Put it in an email.
Yes.
So.
How many kids are in the senior class?
About 100.
About 100, okay.
92.
92?
Okay. I love that you know so all that.
Well, it's just
yeah, and I think the transcript said 87, didn't they? 80,
that's for rank, but there's 92.
Okay, for rank, 86, yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So what does that have? Why is that different?
Well, like transfer students.
The rank.
It makes me nuts. Don't even get me going on that one.
Okay. one controversy per night. So.
Oh, if you're a transfer student,
yes,
you don't
get a rank.
Yeah.
That's not true. If you come in after the sophomore year.
Yeah, your junior and senior year.
Because we can't. We can't.
I know. I get it. It's apples and oranges.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. This is personal, right, Suzanne? You know.
Oh, whatever.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, Peter.
Yes. Thank you.
Welcome.
Can we talk about school choice? I sent an email out today.
Yeah, sure.
Because I look at these all the time, and for some reason I'm looking at them now, and I'm like, I am having such a hard time with these numbers that I'm thinking I must be...
Where am I?
Losing my mind.
Well, because I think the number, every year the number changes grade, right?
Well, every year we solicit the information.
Yeah.
Right? So we send it out in the school's report. Right? So we have the names of the people who are on the list.
Right.
Have we Laura, did you have something for me?
Yet?
Okay.
Have we gotten the official enrollment numbers yet? Don't we usually get those
October
in October?
1.
October 1.
Wes is doing the report now, right? The October 1?
Okay.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks. And I think, I don't know if these are private.
I looked at St. John's because I know we had some kids that came back, mm-hmm. but we had a couple more kids in the middle school that went.
Okay, because of the new middle school.
So that's how come. So I'm like, what? Okay. How can it be 33?
Okay,
you
so
know what I mean?
So
that's what happens.
And there's a few sixth graders that went as well.
Right. Yeah. Not many. If it was 33 and then three in middle school went, there's where the 33 is again.
Right.
Even though there were high school kids who came back.
Mm-hmm. So, but total number of private school students went down from 97 to 90.
So on this one, go down.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So five, 8, 7, 6. Because they were in kindergarten, mm-hmm. 13, first graders, 14.
Okay. The, did you look at my email today that I sent you about it?
About why?
Yeah.
Yep. I looked at your email. So I think your question had to do with sort of like why would maybe kids go to mm-hmm. Ipswich? And again, we don't always know that, but I do know we did lose some kids initially when Corey Seepy ended up being the music director there. There were some kids in the band who had very fond relationships with him. Now Corey's done what Anthony did. Corey left to do the same thing Anthony's doing. But that sometimes happened. I know there was a little there was a little draw there.
When I look at like Peabody though, I'm just thinking what Peabody.
Two.
I mean even the two.
Yeah, I'd have to look at who the kids are, but sometimes what happens is people also if they work in Peabody.
It's more convenient.
Or, you know, let's say their daycare is their mother who lives in Peabody. Mm-hmm. It's just easy. You know, there are situations like that.
Right. Well, it's
right,
just like
we don't know the ages of
teachers our teachers want.
Want their children to see it. Yeah. So that can happen.
Convenient for them.
Right.
Not to mention that we have great schools.
Right. Absolutely, right. Cheryl.
Yes.
Look at Triton. Yeah, Triton, that I don't really understand. That dynamic has been happening.
Yeah, I'm looking at the numbers, and it's just...
I don't know, would it have... Peter, would you have any understanding of that? Like at Triton, would that be maybe because they have more sports opportunities, or...
Why
students would choice to Triton?
I got it. No.
Well, yeah, no, that makes sense.
There's different reasons.
Yeah, I mean, I just...
I mean, you're not supposed to change schools because of sports.
I know that. I know
that. Well, because the music teacher goes there.
Yeah, I know that.
They have like gifted and enrichment programs or anything? No?
No. Not at Triton. Not at the high school level.
I know that sometimes
not different
people,
than we have.
Choice in and out for a change of environment.
What did you say, Peter? I'm sorry.
They chose in and out.
Sometimes they choice in or out for a change of environment.
Yeah. Sometimes people, if their friend goes, they go. You know, that kind of happens sometimes. And, like, we had a couple situations where we know why the children left, right? Mm-hmm. There were personal issues that they felt they needed. Their families felt that was necessary to do it.
I know we talked about it last year. Just a, obviously, they don't need to respond, per se, but a, something of a, why are you leaving?
Why are you leaving? Yeah, that's
just
a good
to get
point.
A sense of, you know, if we suddenly hear a lot of people say the same things, it's an opportunity to
to
figure out what's going on.
And we don't often, sometimes they just do it, like they don't tell us.
They show up next year.
Exactly. But once we get the list, we could certainly send something and just say, you know, we're trying to collect information, you know, would you mind filling out this small survey?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we could do something like that.
So I would imagine it wouldn't be
simple questions.
Super secret information if... No. It wouldn't be something that a family, short of not taking the time to do it, it wouldn't be a secret reason. It would be.
Yeah. I think we can look at that.
Right. And we talked about this. I mean, we've talked about it many times in terms of why people go to, you know.
We don't want anybody to leave, right?
No, we
want to keep everybody.
Right, but we know the drive, you know, a lot of times the driving force isn't because
of the
they're
education.
Unhappy with
That's
the educational
right.
experience
exactly.
here. It's because of... whether the families have, you know, mom, dads have gone, or, you know, just for more of a religious background, you know, things like that. So,
well, and the idea about Triton too, where it's a bigger school,
it's bigger,
right.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
you know, in terms of if you want to go to a larger college, start it with a larger high school. I mean, it's a possibility.
Yeah. I think that's a perception
right.
because the way you know when I look at the students that. You know, where students go from Triton versus where they go from Georgetown, it's very comparable. But I think there's a perception. It's like there's also a perception that if you send your child to St. John's Prep, they're automatically going to get into a better college or they're going to play D1 sports. It doesn't always happen that way, but that's the hope. That's the hope and the dream, right? That's the perception. So,
well, or even just thinking for the student to have an experience with more classmates.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't mean that somebody in Georgetown can't go to the same large college.
No, absolutely not.
No, just look at that college board.
Exactly.
That we've seen
every
it's,
year.
It's amazing.
Every year.
Yeah, it really is.
But I think the
well
quick survey we can
24,000 students.
Yes, your son's doing very well.
Yeah, very happy.
Big school.
The flip side of that is, I guess, if you look at just senior class this year for the outs, it's 40 students, which on the one hand is scary, but if we suddenly had 40 students in, I mean, obviously it would affect our in numbers, but
it would,
that would be a pretty dramatic change.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you, Laura, for that.
You're welcome.
We have donation that... we received, again, we talk about the amount of donations that we get every school committee meeting that we have, and it's very generous that we have, that we live in a community that we live in. So is this anonymous?
Yes, but I think that they said that that we could say that some of the donation comes from quilters, you know, within town. They have like a quilting group, and individual people, they want to remain anonymous, but... They were comfortable with saying that it's donations from people who are part of this quilting group in town, which is incredibly generous.
Okay. Yes, that is very generous. And
it is.
And it is specifically
doing it
used for the food services.
Yep. And they're doing it every month, they said.
Wow.
You know,
really nice.
They come over with it.
So how far has that brought down the count?
The account is more than halfway.
Yeah. Great.
And actually, I think when I looked at it yesterday, there's like 10 people with a balance over $200. But it was a lengthy list, you know, initially. So it's definitely making a difference, and Heather said that if people have gotten on payment plans, you know, they have not have to do the alternative. I mean, I'm about to do a blog really encouraging people to get on My School Bucks, and Heather and I talked about, she said, what if I do like an evening, like I can walk people through it, and I said, yeah, let's do some podcasts on it where people can sort of click on and she can lead them through it so people don't necessarily come. So we're working on something like that too, because if people get on that My School Bucks, I think some people that have emailed me have had bad experience with Unibank, which was the previous thing. Right. So I think they're thinking this is the same thing, and so we really want to have them give this a shot, because, you know, I mean, Pam got on it one day in the office and she could see every single thing that, you know, and her balance, and you can set it for like if my balance goes below $5,
it alerts you when you get emails. Yeah. Is there any parent another pin night? I know we already had one pin night. Is there another night where parents will be, say, at Pembroke that Heather could, you know, do a little presentation on it?
Well, I think that the evenings that are planned now for Pembroke are like the literacy and math night. So I don't know that would be appropriate. But I think Heather, you know, she's willing to do, you know, something specifically having to do with this. But I think a lot of the initial fervor has died down. You know, the few people who are, you know, she's trying weekly to send out the the low balance reminders, and you know, the few people that I've dealt with, you know, as we've explained it to them, you know, I think they're understanding. And I keep saying the problem is a communication, right? Mm-hmm. So if you have this My School Bucks, you know, I guarantee you, if you try it, you're gonna, all the questions and concerns you have are going to be rectified.
Well, and I think the misconception is that you have to pay to be on My School Bucks, which you do
and
not.
And you don't.
And if you pay for your lunch with a check or cash, there's no fee.
Right. It's just if you charge the credit card.
If you use a credit card.
And it's minimal. I mean, it is a fee. It's $1.
But my husband's allergic to fees. He hates fees. It doesn't matter that it's $1.50.
It's convenient.
Yeah. So if folks don't want a fee, there are choices if folks don't want a fee.
Right.
There are choices. Just send in a check.
They will always know what their balance is in real time. They will always know, like, what their children are spending money. Like, there was something on one of Pam's, and she's like, what's that?
Things.
I'm like, so I asked Heather, it was a drink. It's the name of a drink, like a sports drink or something. So, to me, that's the solution if people are, you know, concerned.
Well, and the other thing too, especially with, like some of the kids at Pembroke, they were getting toast, or one in particular was buying toast every day, didn't realize she was paying for it.
Yeah, she didn't realize.
You know, so, but it
adds up.
It adds up, and even, you know, like,
My son, all of a sudden, he started buying pretzels. It's like, this is something new. I had no idea he liked pretzels.
And the kids don't
necessarily... I found out by looking at My School Bucks.
The kids don't necessarily realize
that
that's
a cost. Yeah.
It's a surprise.
Because they don't understand that. Yeah.
I thought it was just the lunches, and I was like, well, why is it going down so quickly? It's all because it's not all he's buying.
But I will put on the blog, because I think Michael raised a question about, you know, like, so everybody's in the system. They're just in the system. But, you know, if a parent doesn't know that the child's ordering toast, right, and all of a sudden they get this balance, I understand why they would contest it. So part of what I'll have to explain in the blog is that if you don't want your child to have the ability to do that, all you have to do is send a note or tell us, and then Heather just puts it right in the system.
So then if the child tries to buy something, they're like,
your parents said no. Right. I mean, that's embarrassing too.
That's
but
almost
so hopefully,
like an alternative lunch.
Right. So hopefully the parent would tell the child.
Yeah, before,
you know,
say
on the ordering, you know.
Right.
So.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad to see that it's looking better.
Yeah.
That is good news. So again, I want to thank this quilting organization for a very generous donation. So I will make a motion to accept, do I say the dollar amount? $88 in cash that was received today that will go towards the arrears in our food services account.
Yes. So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Great. That's very nice. Thank you.
Subcommittee reports?
Oh, yes, my favorite part. Okay.
Budget and finance?
We are meeting on Monday.
I love this.
So when you meet on Monday, will you be meeting with other groups, other finance?
Joe is coming. I believe Joe's coming. I'll confirm that, but.
So Joe, Board of Selectmen?
Was Ed coming?
I have to double check on Ed. I don't know if he is or not.
Yeah, from the Board of Selectmen.
For the last meeting, I actually thought that Ed was going to be there, but he wasn't, so.
So it was just.
It was just us.
Because we were talking about getting a little, quick little agenda for the tribe, some kind of tribe board meeting.
Right, right, the, yeah. And Michael was talking about deliverables, a shared updated school three-year budget projection outlook, including special education, and discuss the same or similar for the town, on the town side. The status update to the town budget analyst, which
I can give you the information in detail.
Goals for future budget and finance meetings, further discussions around revenue generators, prepare a history of the budget cuts made over the past few years. We talked about the budget focus group that could happen, and you were talking, we're talking, I don't know, podcasts.
I was thinking of podcasts.
We have to discuss it further. And that's it.
Okay, so then Monday, 8:30 to 10?
Yes.
You'll be meeting, okay. Governance?
We're meeting on Monday.
You having that right after?
No.
Okay.
It's Michael's day in Georgia.
It's Halloween, too.
Can't afford lunch.
I know, that's what I was saying, so it's gonna be short and sweet. He's gonna walk the kids.
I was gonna say, Halloween might be starting.
No, from 5 to 7.
Oh.
It's officially scheduled.
5 to 7. Public relations?
We met last Friday.
Yeah.
October 21st, and we talked a lot about the satisfaction survey. And for the next survey, we want to make sure most of the questions are going to be the same, so we can compare apples with apples based on the feedback. We were planning to change some of the bus questions to really get a little more satisfaction information. The old questions were more like, do you ride the bus? Which is
we were trying to get a sense of, did we need to do something, right?
Yeah, that was a mission driven
right, what can we
yeah.
Right, and the two bus questions that we were changing to was, buses provided by the schools are on time most days, and my child feels safe on the buses provided by the school. So we then talked a little bit about the communicating the budget, which via the satisfaction survey last year, it seemed like folks wanted more input as to what mode of communication they got. So we were thinking of a very short survey. So before we do 10 things to communicate, maybe they just want 2 or 3.
Yeah, we're thinking about listing the various kind of communication
venues.
Right,
and all the ideas are in the minutes, but social media, Georgetown Television, morning announcements, podcasts, etc. And Pam and I looked at the district website. Pam looked at the middle high school, particularly. I looked at Pearlie and Pembroke, and we just made some suggestions of how to update things that are just out of date, that they might want to update. But we determined that we do have excellent websites.
Right, yeah, it was just in the spirit of continuous improvement. And actually, I looked at a lot of other high school websites, and I think ours is fabulous. We have a lot of really important, relevant, timely information.
Right, and our November meeting, we're going to look at indicators of excellence. That's it. Laura, did you get those minutes?
Okay, start school later. We did meet, and we have a meeting scheduled for the 28th of November. We're also right now in the process of having Dr. Owens come for a community forum. We're looking the first week of March.
to have her come out and talk. And we would hope that the community comes out, because I think it would be a really great opportunity for people to ask questions that they may have. Mm-hmm. So that will be on the Facebook page as soon as a date is confirmed, and then we'll also have it on the website and things like that. So we did also ask for new members, anyone that would like to be a part of the committee. I know it's in the morning announcements. Anybody that's interested can just send me an email. We're also looking for staff, as well as community members, parents. So we still have the same amount of people. It's not that anyone's dropped out. It's just that we figured that the more the merrier. And if anybody would like to even just attend a meeting, they're more than welcome to do that too. Mm-hmm. Superintendent evaluation. What about the new member orientation?
Yes, we did meet.
Okay, I remember last time we talked about that.
October 14th. And we, Carol brought some school committee policies that we already have in place. In fact, the entire section of B is kind of all around board governance and a lot of information that new members would find very helpful. But so we just began to structure the school committee welcome packet. The idea is that it would be a total of 11 one-page welcome and then 10 single pages on different topics to facilitate kind of an initial discussion when a new member comes onto the committee, that they would have a meeting with the superintendent and the chair, and that the superintendent and the chair could then use this document, which of course would go to the new committee member previously before, but just to, as a guide of what to talk about, you know, and if then the new member could have read this ahead of time, they might have questions about it, but you know, just, I mean, I think a lot of us, probably when we first came on the committee, and there's so much to learn, and mm-hmm. we don't want this document to turn into something that's going to create a meeting that's going to last 6 hours. Mm-hmm. That's not the point. Mm-hmm. It's just a way to direct initial lines of inquiry and, you know, help the new member to learn what they need to learn as quickly as possible.
Well, and as far as the charting the course binder, a lot of the topics that we would include I have found in there, and when I went to the class it was, I don't know, 4 or 5 hours.
Yeah, it's quite so extensive,
but
it's supposed to be like 8, and usually they I don't think I know anyone that stayed for the whole
it was
8 hours.
Wow.
No, they're good about getting, you know,
they
like working through lunch.
Yes.
And
but the point being is the amount of information in that binder wasn't close to being covered in full. So
right.
But again, the topics that we talked about, there are documents that we can utilize to put together these.
I mean, I think the idea of going over all this information can be very overwhelming, which is why something like this, but you said something like this was drafted before.
Well, no, Ann and Annie, when they were on it, that one of the school committee goals that came out of their school committee evaluation was this need for a new, you know, and Laura actually went back in the archives, and it really was a list of the things. So what was supposed to happen is the chair was supposed to meet with the new member, and then it was just this list of these are the things that you would want to cover, like,
right,
you know,
well, this is kind of
not necessarily always policy, but kind of like how do you handle, you know, if you're a parent with being a school committee member, if you have something you want to talk about in the school,
right.
It was those kind of things, like sort of the little tips that charting the course doesn't necessarily
no,
cover.
Barbie did a great job
right.
of
yep.
doing
yeah.
that.
Yeah,
oh,
yeah.
Thank
so
you.
So
she
that
she made a point to meet. I know.
Right. You. So that's great. And so the question is, you know, what would you, maybe we could get some feedback on.
Right.
Well, what did you find most helpful?
Mm-hmm.
Like,
mm-hmm.
so we can make sure that it is accommodated
right.
for
yeah.
in the orientation.
And actually,
packet.
Yeah, the first page of this, it comes straight from a wonderful email that mm-hmm. Anne Blythe sent to all of us at some time that
mm-hmm.
really had a lot of great information, like what you're talking about. But yeah, I mean, charting the course is great, and but oftentimes it's far away, it's on the Cape, and it's not always easy. It's not always easy for new members to find a time to go.
Exactly. Well, I was going to ask you that.
But sometimes it takes a while.
Well, it is because it's so far away.
Yeah, we went to a really close one at
Essex. You went to, which, Essex Tech?
Essex
Tech. You're aging yourself.
I am.
How was the other one we went to? Oh, that was the superintendent one.
Right.
Yeah, so it was at Six Aggie.
Yeah, which is very close. Like that, but
that
there
wasn't
has
available
been a time
when
that,
I was...
It was
well,
great.
They rotated around. No.
And it was full. It was full.
Yeah.
Yeah, because so people snag it up when it's local.
Mm-hmm.
Well, no,
I wish they
would
have it.
They
have to go closer.
They do it regionally.
And more frequently, because it seems like they're just quarterly.
Mm-hmm. Somewhere at the Cape.
Okay,
I know.
That's right.
So we're working on it.
That's a conference.
Oh, you do the conference, right? And speaking of the conference is coming up
next week.
It's coming up next week, which will be.
It is scheduled when I-95 is going to be closed, which is going to be fantastic.
I know. Did you know that?
Really?
In Newton,
what?
They're replacing a bridge in Newton, so they're closing like a 2-mile stretch of 95.
Oh my goodness!
Which is going to be fun.
But do they detour people then off of 95?
Just onto local roads.
Just go through Boston.
Yeah, it's just everyone is going to be doing
this.
Yeah. It's just going to be a traffic-y.
Yes. Okay, so the
traffic fun. It's next week.
Right. And are you staying for Saturdays?
I am. Yeah.
Okay. Are you going to be coming to the stats board later?
I am.
A heckler
piano. Well, when we asked Mike Gilbert, the superintendent sent Mike Gilbert an email just asking him, like, how many people are you expecting? I thought that was a large number.
He said 35 to 40.
I thought it was more than that.
I'll have to look.
50.
I thought he said, well, maybe it could have been.
I thought that was a lot, because I know you had said, too, that on Saturdays the attendance seems to dwindle.
Yeah.
But if it's a hot topic, people will stay.
Well, I'd like.
That's why they put it
that
day.
If we're making the trip out there, I'd like it to be a lot of people.
Students on Saturday, they have a bunch of students. Sessions, student-led, there's a student lunch, and there's some student kind of focus forums, so maybe you might get students.
No, that's interesting. Possible. Yep, so
and
that
relevant,
would be good.
Certainly.
Well, good. I'm looking forward to hearing how you find it this year, you know, because you've attended before, so it's...
So it's a good comparison.
Yeah,
so.
Just to get an idea. And you've already signed up for all the ones that you...
No, you just kind of go.
You don't
you
have
decide,
to sign up. You
no.
can just go from room to room and...
Okay. Actually,
I know
what
Naomi's
a lot of people do
one.
Is
she? She's going to be there. I forget the.
Yeah, I think she's been there.
Our attorney is going to be what?
Former attorney.
Former attorney. Yes.
No, she still calls herself an attorney.
Yeah, so she'll be there.
And actually, Mark Abrams, the guy who was, he's doing one. He told me today he's doing one on OPEB.
Oh,
you
really?
Know,
have you selected the ones you'd like to attend?
I've certainly looked at the schedule. What a lot of people do is they'll go. Just because it's very often, because there will be 10 sessions during a given hour and a half, I think the sessions run. So a lot of people do the first half here,
and
then
run
the second half at another one, just to be able to get a flavor of two.
The school building.
Yes. Our next meeting is probably November 15th. And Carol, I just texted you a picture of what I've noticed on the high school roof. There's a place in the back around the band.
How are you on the roof?
I'm up in the soccer field. I go up in the soccer fields, and you can see like over the band room.
Oh, really?
There's this puddle that doesn't go away.
Oh, okay.
I wanted to let you all know about that.
Okay.
But that's it. We haven't had a meeting since our last school committee meeting.
Okay. So she'll talk to him. Show Mike about
that. We'll definitely show people about that.
Yeah. So CPAC, I want to hear about last evening's
Tom's
event.
Here too. Tom is the president of the CPAC.
Hi, Tom.
It was so excited.
How are you?
Do you want to come up and talk about last night?
Yeah.
Sure, I can come up briefly.
Is that the trunk? Yeah, I want to make sure he can come on November 17th too.
Oh, okay.
Last night we had our trick-or-trunk event at Pembroke School.
Do you want to just introduce yourself for those that don't know you?
I'm Tom Stewart. I'm the chair of the CPAC.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank yes. You. Welcome. Thank you.
Thank
for coming.
You.
Didn't know you were going to be presenting, did you?
No, I didn't. So we had our trick or trunk event, and we had a great turnout. It's the first one. Jen Berge, our fundraising chair, ran it. And we had over 300 people.
It was unbelievable.
It was amazing. So much fun.
Everyone had a good time. And, you know, I've been a special ed parent for 12 years, and I've never seen so many people at a CPAC event. So,
yeah, it was wonderful.
So we're really very, very excited.
Yeah.
We had some sponsors. I do have their names here. So
yeah, sure. You can give them a perk.
Pomodori, you know, donated pizza, and Swim Angel Fish. Tamara Schofield from Century 21 North Shore, the George Home Improvements. They also sponsored our first CPAC workshop with Tim Sindelar on the basic rights. And Brandon and Caleb Hardy, who are financial planners, they do a lot of work with special needs families. Okay. And Dunkin' Donuts, they were amazing. Gave us donuts, munchkins, hot chocolate. They were there the whole night.
That's so nice of them.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Dolly and Robert, they did do a great job. Yeah. So I want to give them a special plug.
Yeah, sure.
So, we're very excited. You know, we didn't expect 300 people. And everyone's already talking about next year.
That's the competition.
Absolutely.
The competition would be fierce next year. I already heard people saying, oh, well, now that I know what the standard is, boy, I'm up in the ante. I'm already planning my trunk theme for next year. So there were some people who really went, like,
it's
gonna all out.
It's going to start a whole new Halloween-y spirit in Georgetown.
Carol had a great costume, too.
And the police.
Oh, I think I saw a picture of
amazing.
That.
Yes, yes.
I don't know what was Jack's costume?
Jack was a pizza.
Oh, I was like, what is he?
That was pepperoni all over him.
Really, it was a pizza.
I didn't know that. And Cheryl decorated her trunk.
Yeah.
And
Cheryl was there, decorated up.
I did.
I was there.
It was cold, but at least it wasn't raining.
It was just the right amount. I mean, it was the right amount of time when the kids were actually trick or treating.
Mm-hmm.
Right, I mean, people started pulling out about 7-ish, I would
say.
Yeah,
right around there,
yeah. Right around.
Perfect.
And if they came, Cheryl was the overachiever, as always. She was there very early. But, you know, if you came at 5:30, 6:00, you know, I think the parade started at like 6:15.
Right around there.
So, but it was so festive. I mean, people had candelabras and tiki torches
so
and ghouls and goblins.
That's
and
awesome.
Some people did... one lady was dressed as Hillary Clinton, right?
Oh,
she's sitting on the back of the trunk, and she was like, I thought she was a statue. I thought it was somebody had brought like a statue. Well, I realized she was passing out candy after a while, but it was really pretty funny, I have to say.
And the kids with their costumes.
The
I
kids
mean, there
were so cute.
There were so many different costumes.
I don't know what they're going to do with all that candy and then go trick-or-treating on Halloween. My goodness, some dental bills that hopefully don't come to see back or us.
You know, everyone had a really great,
it was,
great time.
It was.
And I know they're all looking forward to next year.
It was a great event.
Yeah, you don't want to try to not do it next year.
They were already talking about what we're going to do next year, how to improve it, and
Cheryl had an idea too.
So yeah, we're open to suggestions on that. So our next training is on Monday, November 14th, effective team meetings at Flatbreads, and we have a sponsor. Our first training and our meet and greet, we got around 26 people.
Yeah, wow.
So
that's a great location too, I thought.
For the meet and greet.
For the meet and greet.
Yeah, at the Grange Hall.
Oh, that was lovely.
It was
really
beautiful.
Was.
They've done a great job.
The whole upstairs that he redid.
I don't even know where the Grange Hall is.
Oh, no, it's the old Pentucket
workshop. It's the old
Pentucket
workshop.
At the library.
Oh,
so it brought back a lot of wonderful memories.
He did a great job there.
The way that the new owner has done it.
He's done a marvelous job. The building is great.
Yeah, it is. It's beautiful.
It's beautiful.
Oh, all these oriental rugs, all kinds of
couches, and big wing chairs.
Beautiful there.
And people brought all kinds of wonderful hors d'oeuvres and food.
Yep.
And
it was really good.
Oh, that's awesome.
So on November 17th.
Monday, November 14th.
No, but what are the dates? We're looking for him to come on the 17th.
Oh, so Tom, so we were planning the year agendas.
Okay.
And so we wondered if the CPAC, because at one point we were having you come early and then it wasn't a good time for you guys. We wondered if you and whoever you want to bring could do just a very short, like a little presentation, similar to what you're doing right now, actually, on November 17th.
It's a possibility. Yeah. I'll get back to you.
Yeah, check on that because we thought we were going to also have the PTA and GEF do something very quickly on that same.
Sure.
Just on the spirit of all the parent groups that are working to support the students.
Sure, thank you.
Yeah,
Our next training is November 14th at Flatbreads. And,
with attorney Tim Sindelar?
Yeah, attorney attorneys Tim Sindelar on effective team meetings. And we have sponsors for the events, so we all eat pizza, and it's a kind of a nice night out. So
how did you get the sponsors? Did you just go out and...
Well, what we did was when I was elected and Chantel was elected treasurer, we had a meeting. We made two ad hoc chair positions, mm-hmm. Desiree Edwards and Jen Berge. And so the four of us, we made like a management team. So we've been working interchangeably. I don't know how one person would ever be the CPAC chair mm-hmm. and do everything. If you look at the bylaws and the mission statement, it's an awful lot of work for one person. It's a lot of work for four people.
Yeah.
So, Desiree and Chantel and Jen, they have worked hard to get sponsors.
That's great.
For different events. And so our very first sponsor, though, is the George Home Improvements. I tell him, I always remember that. He stepped up and helped us out.
That's nice.
In a big way. So.
Well, and even the event last night, you made a good amount of money, I'd say.
Yeah, I don't have the exact figure. We got some extra money coming in, and I think it's around $1,500.
Wow, that's great. That's fabulous.
So it's,
But you basically sold out. I mean, there was, even though not everybody didn't buy ahead, like, would have been helpful, but then people came through and you had room.
But, for the first time, it was a perfect size.
Yes.
If it was any bigger... We might have got a little nervous around managing it because it's our first event. Right?
There were a lot of people there, but the fire department was there.
Yeah. And the police too, right?
Yep,
the police
officer
were there.
Officer Henry was
all really
getting
helpful.
His picture taken with all the children. Yep.
So he didn't have to go far for his costume.
He didn't have to go far for his costume.
No, I think that's
but
great.
But the nicest part, though, was everyone just was very positive, had a great time.
There's a sense of community.
Didn't have any, no issues. I mean, it was just a wonderful experience. We we're all very, very happy today.
Yeah.
I know it's always nice the day after the event, isn't it?
You should be very proud. I mean, it was an amazing job you all did at putting it
together.
Jen
Berge did a great job. I mean, this was her, she said it was like planning a wedding.
Yes, she did say that. She did say
that.
She'll be prepared
for her
children.
Well, it's amazing because I'm on the CPAC Facebook page, and the publicity that Chantel and Desiree have done, along with Jen.
That's good.
It's
getting
a lot
the word
of
out
communication,
for sure.
A lot of publicity about all their events.
The four of us have worked well together. It's hardly a day when we're not emailing or texting or talking to each other. So it's been a great experience for all of us. So really looking forward to CPAC continuing to grow. So
that's great. Well, we appreciate you taking on that big responsibility. We know how big of a deal it is. But we look forward to, if you would like to come on the 17th, if that works for you, let us know and then invite.
Bring your friends.
Yeah, sure.
Invite the other three individuals too. We'd love to hear about it.
Thank you all very much.
Yeah.
Really appreciate
it.
Thank you.
So on to old business. We have to, since Joan and Donna have left the district, we need to take care of a few things. So we are going to, I'll make a motion to appoint Jack Tiano as the homeless liaison for the 2016-2017 school year, and to appoint Suzanne Sutherland as the Title IX and Title VI
and
sexual harassment officer.
There you go. You got a big job.
To Jack Tiano. Okay. sexual harassment officer for the 2016-2017 school year. That is a big
so
job.
Moved.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Suzanne, are you ready for that?
Thankfully, we don't have to call her into action, too.
Okay, student activity account. So, sixth grade Camp Kiev trip, which is coming up soon.
Yes.
November, like, I think it's around...
It's really
that
close.
15th or something.
Yeah.
Which is, yeah, I was talking to a couple of the parents today, actually, that are sending their kids off, and they said the kids are so excited to go,
yeah,
which is always nice. So I will make a motion to increase the middle school student activity account to $30,000 for the period of October 1st to November 30th, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. I hope they have a great trip. And that it's not too cold.
Yeah.
Right.
We have some surplus everyday math books that are outdated. And Mr. Crossman went through those.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
He's the one who provided the list.
Yep. So I'll make a motion to declare the list of everyday math books provided by Mr. John Crossman as surplus to be disposed of by proper protocol as presented.
So moved. Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, and then we also provided the
we did. I just wanted I sent you a and I sent you a quick
yeah,
email today,
that.
Barbie, just to just wanted to suggest moving just a couple things after
oh,
talking
yes,
to the administrative team.
Yep.
But it just so it just involved the December 8th and January 12th. So on December 8th, since we're doing the 1-to-1 technology and the pilot program, we want to move technology integration up there. So we focus on technology for that whole time. And then Jack wants to move the middle high school special ed and RTI down to the 12th because he wants to have the continuum of services. So he wants to start with Pembroke and then he wants to go to the middle high school. So it just, that was their thought today was just to move those. I mean,
and
when
what
I
do
met
we do with the 1-to-1?
The 1-to-1, we're leaving right where it
oh,
is.
What else
move
did you
move
say?
Technology up.
Oh, move technology up. Perfect. Yeah, that works. Good.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then
so
just move Jack down to the 12th.
Yep.
And
okay.
And then the other thing was on the back was just confirming. Originally, when we were doing this, once it was confirmed, we put it in dark bold. And so I just want to confirm that the science vertical team, elementary science curriculum, and the health and wellness vertical team will all be confirmed for that April date.
I think it looks good with the other two items that are on there. I think
right.
It'll work out fine.
Right,
so
it
we
should.
Can bold them.
Yep, we'll bold
so,
them.
Yeah.
So now for the first time, I
no the virtual team.
Oh, virtual team.
Sounds very it sounds very futuristic.
Oh, what did I say? Vertical team. It should be vertical.
Is it vertical? I'm looking at virtual. I was like,
it
what?
Should be vertical.
Where's vertical?
April 13th.
Yeah.
April 13th.
Sorry,
oh,
for
okay.
28.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
Okay, yeah, that looks good.
Okay,
we
so
it.
We can make that change and we'll bold everything and
so,
give you a revised list.
So basically we're changing the December 8th with the January. We're
yes.
Yep.
Okay.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yep.
Because for the first time I put the topics up on the Facebook page, the
uh-oh.
District Facebook page
oh, okay.
for tonight so the people could know what we were going to discuss. Yep. And if I can do that every,
that's,
you know, that's
well, we'll
so
give
I
you the,
get
we'll
people,
give you one that's final.
Yeah. Idea. Okay.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you for doing that.
Idea of what we're going to be talking about.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
Don't put those away.
Yes, actually.
I was just, yeah. Would you mind?
Yeah,
just
no.
Talking a little bit about today's visit.
Oh, good.
Michael
yeah.
Had.
Now that everyone else who went has left, that's perfect timing.
So
I.
So who did attend?
It was Peter, Wes, Colin, Sandra,
you,
myself, me, and I feel like I'm missing one person. Thank you for that.
I thought that's who.
Yeah, I think that was it. Oh, and
it,
Carol.
It was supposed
was
to be
there.
Me.
Who yes.
Okay, so you went to Hamilton Wenham.
We went to Hamilton Wenham. Met with their IT director and assistant principal, and I guess they are. This is the first year that they're full 9-to-12. So they did 9-10
yeah.
the first year, and then have been backfilling. As the ninth graders come in.
Yeah.
So sort of for the first time, the entire school is 1-to-1
okay.
And running. And we actually got to sit in on a few classes. It was a Spanish class, a math class, and a bio class, I think it was. And for the first time kind of saw the iPads being used.
How big is their school? How many kids?
Their district, I think they said, was 1,800
something. They're a little
bit bigger than us.
Their classes were about 150.
And how many kids were in the classes that you sat in?
20, okay. Low to mid-20s maybe.
Yeah.
So manageable size. But it was really neat to see the... We went into three very different classes, and it didn't feel at all planned. We went into a Spanish class, and they were doing a kind of a vocabulary lesson, which was kind of, it was a game. The one that got me was the math class. They were doing something on graphing and variables, and what I liked about it is none of the students were using their iPads for it, but the teacher was. So instead of sort of the old overhead projector standing mm-hmm. at the front and trying to figure out how to write upside down and backwards yeah. and erasing it, she was just writing on her iPad and just able to, first of all, be around the room and working with the students. And it was a lot more interactive, I thought, than kind of the old.
So then where,
style.
So what so she's then, writing down, what
it goes shows off. Up on the projector. Okay. And it was a very smooth, flawless interaction between the two,
okay.
which was really good.
So it was so like an interactive whiteboard?
In a large
it's,
part,
it's like
yeah.
using Apple TV and you're projecting it through your laptop or iPad, and so it's up there. And there are interactive pens that you can use for it.
So you can write on the board with the pens. Right, like a smart board.
Like a yeah. smart board, only they're pens.
Okay.
And in a lot of ways it looks and feels like a smart board.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know... If you didn't see her in the back of the room, I don't know if you necessarily realized that it wasn't, I don't want to say just a smart board, but that it wasn't a smart board.
Probably the next
doing
step
it.
In technology.
Yes. It's exactly what it is. But then they have something that I know Peter loves called the Power Block.
Oh, yes.
And I'll let him talk
I've been
about
talking
it.
About the Power Block with him for years. I'm thrilled
heard
he saw
it.
It was a very
Power Block?
Open period of time
yes.
for the students
yes.
to kind of do whatever they needed to do.
So that's kind of like that Eagle Block and things that we've talked about at Start School Later meetings.
Yep. Yeah.
It's oh, yeah.
Right.
It's
like an empty block.
Yeah.
It gives the kids opportunities
exactly
to make choices.
Was.
Yeah.
And it the way
so they have it.
So they have it. I think it was 36 minutes if I remember something like that. And it's a common it's the full spectrum of the students need to stay in the school, but
mm-hmm.
they can go anywhere they want.
Library.
So it's library kind of office hours with teachers, group projects, or some of them we're treating as a study hall, but not a bad thing necessarily.
Yeah.
So it was kind of it was good to see that, but I would say 90% of the students were doing work of some sort. It wasn't just
mm-hmm.
it wasn't a free half an hour.
No.
So we visited some classes and then we talked with the assistant principal and the IT director about kind of logistics and what their experience has been and their model, the model that they have is very similar to what Peter's trying to accomplish.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it was really helpful to see kind of the live version of where we want to be in
mm.
3 or 4 or 5 mm-hmm. years.
And let, I hate to say it, but let them make the mistakes
well.
And then we...
Well,
right.
You do. You learn from others.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm sure they're very good about telling us what they wish they had done differently.
And that was Colin when we walked in and someone said, you know, what can I, how, you know, what do you want to learn about today? He's like, well, I kind of want to learn about the things that you screwed up. and it was very, you know, we
yeah.
did it, we figured it out, and we've tweaked and they said that they borrowed everything that they did from Burlington because
mm-hmm.
oh, Burlington
yeah.
did it.
Burlington
was
how
many years
went to Burlington?
We went to Burlington
yeah.
doing
yeah.
too.
They are in their, I think it's their.
Well, if the whole school
well,
was older
it was,
now,
it was
ten.
4
so
years. Well, they did 9 and 10
9
together,
and 10.
But they did. They had one. Whereas we're doing, Sandra is doing her one class as a pilot. They did a group of essentially an entire classroom of kids. So they had 20 kids
mm-hmm.
do a pilot. In all of their classes.
Right. So those kids,
so
were
they,
those
kids
following
moved,
each other?
Yeah.
Oh.
Into so
each
they said
class.
It was
okay.
challenging in the sense that it was the same 20 kids
doing it,
following
each other,
you know,
yeah.
for the entire day. But
for
they
the
got
school, yeah.
a good way to sort of see how the iPads worked in an English class. Because that was one of their concerns is how would it really work?
Yeah, I'm really
in
excited
English
to hear
class.
How, when Sandra comes to a meeting, how it's going with
yeah.
that.
Well, she's an adamant, you have to have keyboards.
Oh, really?
Very strongly, but which we figure that into the price.
We discuss keyboards, we discuss cases, yeah, we talked essentially about everything, which was really nice. They feel very strongly about their tech integrationists. Mm-hmm.
We do too.
I was going to say, we do too.
Yeah. I think from their perspective, it was kind of a deal breaker.
To not
it, it wouldn't have worked if they didn't have it. Mm-hmm. But interestingly, both of their integrationists came out of a special education background. Mm. So we're already sort of looking at tools, looking at how to use tools to target individual students and how to make it work with everyone. So kind of a unique perspective on how do we use this device to maximize its value.
So tell me how many people they have in that group.
In what group?
The IT.
Their IT department
team?
Is 7 people for the district. So they were 2, and I don't have those notes. They're 2 elementaries, 1 middle and 1 high school. No, I feel like they're 3 elementaries.
That's,
I think
well,
it's
Essex,
5 schools.
Right.
They have 4 or 5 schools.
I mean, Hamilton. Okay.
So they have 7 people. Everyone has a different job, but everyone can kind of do everything. They are putting lots and lots of stuff out onto the web, into the cloud, I should say.
Okay.
So it's less maintenance, less local maintenance.
Which was what we're talking about.
Yeah.
Into the cloud.
So it's less bodies in the building to do things that can be done.
Right.
Off-site.
And then they also utilize the kids.
Yep, they have a student help desk,
yeah.
which
sounds
like
a
really
big. They
handle
the little stuff, and then
which
is great.
We kind of have that already
yep.
too. But the special education background makes sense because it's mm-hmm. kind of like assistive technology for everyone.
That's exactly the way they kind of approach it.
Yeah. The district that Jack came from, did they have one to one?
Carlisle?
Concord.
I didn't think so, but
no, okay.
but I don't know that for sure.
They're not. I don't think they do.
Okay.
But they talked about kind of the rollout and the difference between the bring your own and then the ones who are leasing through the school. They actually use it through My School Box is their
mm-hmm.
payment mechanism, which I was actually thinking it would, I don't want to say force, but it would sort of force parents to use My School Box if they're at the middle high school.
Right.
If they're already in there, then they're there for the lunch. For the food services.
You mean
as well,
for the payment of the
yes.
of the
yeah,
of the lease payment.
Okay.
So their lease payments. I know
we're looking at a different. Yeah,
yeah,
we're looking at a different.
It just seemed like a neat.
We're looking
yeah.
at that company mm-hmm. that which
the,
one was it?
The
is it?
Fax
yeah.
was the name.
Then we talked about they did some scholarship units. All but 1 or 2 students. They only had 1 or 2 students per class opt out, which is actually much lower than.
Because we were figuring we might need 6%.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So when you say opt out,
yeah.
does that mean they don't want to?
They don't want to buy it.
Right.
Or they
okay.
don't want to lease
it
to the school. So they get a loaner
from us.
Through
from
the
us.
School.
Through
but
the
it
school.
Stays
okay.
at the school.
Yeah.
So we have some computers, because we're talking about that in our plan. We have some computers that, you know, could fit that bill.
Yeah.
But we're also talking about the need to, you know, depending on how much, what percentage we think, but in looking at, you know, Wes had some money in his technology. Remember, he had $11,000 in his technology budget. If we just left that in the technology budget and we just said we're going to use that to purchase
mm-hmm.
iPads, then that covers that cost.
Mm-hmm.
The big question for us, you know, and we'll have to discuss this when we get to the point, but is you know, the you have to make a first lease payment. You have to make a first lease payment before you collect all the money from
mm-hmm.
the people. So the district does have to at least identify
mm-hmm.
a source. So you say, let's just use school choice. So $12,000 is the payment. You take $12,000 from choice, and as people pay you, you're paying yourself back. So that's kind of where,
yep.
you know, that's probably what I'll propose to you, but we have to look at school choice at the revolving account and see whether
not
that
to put you on the spot, but when are we thinking about talking
to the parents?
The community.
Okay.
About
well,
it.
We do know that. We do know that answer. That information. We are.
Should be in the minutes.
Yeah, I don't have. I'm thinking that we talked about doing that I want to say January 15th or 18th.
Yeah, you had a date.
There is a date.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, it's in my little.
So
it's in my little. My little goals update.
It's in there too.
That's right.
Didn't I put it in there?
You did. Okay.
So what will happen is we'll come to the school committee in December.
1/18, January 18.
So we have to formulate our, get our written plan together. We'll bring it to the school committee on the 8th, and then we'll go to the parents.
Am I thinking the 18th was the Alice Community Forum? When is that? Oh, that's in January too.
I don't think the Alice one's been scheduled yet. I think the chief has to confirm that. I think we said January 19th was when we were talking about doing that, actually.
January
19th?
Yeah.
Also the day after.
So that might be a little problem, but we can change the Alice one. I'm not really worried about that. Or we can change this one, it doesn't matter, but there's enough time. But we wanted to do it in January, because then we wanted to bring, if we're doing my school, I don't know how we're gonna do that, we have to meet when we talk about that. But let's say we're using this fax company, they will come, they will be there at the meeting, right? So we'll do the, this is what we wanna do, this is the cost, all of the things we have to do. And by the way, here are the people, here are the options for payment, and here's the person here who can answer questions, you know, for you. And then the goal would be to have, to know, to be ready to, you know, get the orders in, you know, by April, right? And then have all the POs ready to go, order the information, get it over the summer, get the computers all programmed with what we need, and then have there be a day or an evening or a day where parents can come with their student, pick up the iPad, make sure they sign the acceptable use policy, you know, so we have all that good to go. So day one, the students would have their iPads.
What I really liked that they did, they said their first couple of days of school for their incoming freshmen, they don't follow the regular schedule. It's kind of a special day for the incoming freshmen to talk about, you know, what it's like to be in high school and all that stuff. But they actually have sessions on the iPad. So they've narrowed it down to a handful of apps that they sort of, not that they're approved by the school, but that everyone is sort of using. So a Notability or a Socrative too. So then they have kind of workshops with the students. So
that's
that
a great idea.
Kind of day one in the classroom, they know how to use, you know, hey, if you want to take notes on your iPad, this is how you do it. If you want to do, they're all set up in Google Suite or Google for
they're doing
classroom,
Google Classroom, the Google Classroom, yeah.
But here's how it works. They set up all their folders the same way, so it's, you know, so that it's a kind of a smooth transition.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
I think we're really lucky to have this district so close to us.
Yes.
Yeah, and they were,
you know,
they were
welcoming us into their school and showing us
in offering.
Yeah, that's great.
And Essex Tech is doing it too. But we think, according to the Apple representative, he feels like this district is
a closer fit
and match to what we're looking to do. Mm. So.
And I guess my last comment is one of the, what did you do wrong? They submitted their budget requests to the school committee in, you know, November, December, but they didn't actually talk with their parents until, I guess it was approved kind of in the February timeline. And they said they wished, in hindsight, that they'd started back, essentially submit the budget and then talk to parents at the same time, just to broaden that window.
Yeah.
Which I thought was a helpful.
Yeah.
So they didn't have much pushback in terms of
people not wanting
to do it,
and they don't have any much problem with people not paying the bills.
They said they've virtually none.
That's right. The company will.
Yeah, they take care of
people.
That.
The assistant principal said, I actually asked him that very question. He said what they, I guess they do it mostly internally because it's a My School Box kind of a thing. Mm-hmm. So if a student doesn't pay a given, or if the family doesn't pay a given month's iPad fee, they can control it locally and turn it off. And the goal is not to punish the student, because there is a loaner in the library.
Right.
So the student has access to an iPad, they're not taking it away, but they can turn it off essentially in the school.
That's great.
So if there is an issue at home or something happens, the student can talk to the assistant principal, and 10 minutes later it's back on. So it's not a, it's an easy fix.
Right. Yeah, and I think we can do that as well because we're insisting we put the management system on.
Right.
So I think that's how we would do it if we knew there was somebody that was in that situation.
Yeah, if there's a kind of a mitigating.
Yeah.
So when you were in these classrooms, so the kids don't have any textbooks at all.
I don't even know the answer. No, there were some.
Yeah.
The iPads as of now are not replacing textbooks.
Okay. So it's supplemental.
Mm-hmm. Okay. There is the idea that they will someday replace them, but it's not there mm-hmm. yet.
Right, because I know like in Methuen, where a friend of mine's daughter goes, that's all she has is just
the iPad. Really?
So they just bring, they don't have any textbook.
It's no.
So
no
they might have access to electronic textbooks.
Right, it's all loaded on.
Yeah, that's
loaded
what,
on.
Yeah.
It's loaded on.
So
the
it's
iPad.
So simple, that's what she brings mm-hmm. home and...
And
it's great.
Not
it's really
surprising, because I actually, well, you know, it seems like a much easier, cheaper way to do it. Not surprisingly, the textbook publishers,
yeah.
it's $100 for the book or
$100
bucks
for
the
software.
So,
yeah.
It's,
right.
no,
is,
it's
yeah,
not
it's
a,
not
a
dollar
savings. What I did, and a totally unrelated thing, there's an open source textbook movement that I was actually just reading about.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of buying the Prenhall math textbook or whatever it is, there's a significant amount of open source free
yeah.
curriculum.
I listened to a podcast
yeah.
about that. Yeah.
Which is
a lot of stuff in open
I
source.
I mean, you know, it's anecdotal, but it was a school saving $80,000 a year on
mm-hmm.
on textbooks.
Wow.
And,
wow.
Mm-hmm. But it comes with cost. I mean, open source isn't necessarily the same quality or
right.
doesn't exactly
right.
align
you
with
can't
what you're
guarantee
trying to
that
do,
the information
or...
in the books are real, are true.
It's not like a Wikipedia. So it's just an interesting once you sort of break down the barriers a little, the structure a little bit, it opens a lot of doors to be able to do other stuff. But it was a really good visit. They were very very helpful. Come back anytime. And made very clear that they stole it all from Burlington, and that's kind of the motto is
right.
we're
and
doing
steal
it,
it from us.
And you can steal it from us as long as you provide it to
mm-hmm.
whoever's
forward.
Doing it next.
Right.
So
that's great.
Yeah.
Really
nice.
Thank
happy
you for calling
to
that
yeah.
today. That must have
yeah.
taken
yeah.
a
it was
of
a really
hours
good day.
Out of your day
but,
to go and do that.
Yeah, yeah and everybody
nice.
That went had that same, because I talked to Peter and I talked to Wes, and they had the same response as you,
that's
that they
great.
Thought it was well worth the time. They really enjoyed seeing it, you know. And he said, Peter said, and I, when I saw that power block, I'm like, I wish Carol was here. This is what
she's
been telling.
He was taking pictures.
This is what she's been talking to me about.
Okay, well, that's interesting, though, because that could work out for the Start School Later movement.
Right?
Maybe. Well, we've been talking about this.
Well, I don't think he's talking about being less instructional time, because I think their periods
is
are different amounts
learning?
Of time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well,
they also have.
Yes, it is time on learning.
Wednesday,
but
they're at it. 1 o'clock or something, because they have PD every Wednesday.
I
so
know.
They,
oh,
they
right.
have a,
they
have
get
a
half
to,
no,
they have
half
a,
day.
A
there's, it's very different, yeah.
But it was interesting. There.
But he said there were 70-minute classes, a couple
yeah.
periods.
But I had that back in the 70s in my high school. I spent most
what,
of the time.
Half days? Or what?
No, the free time.
Oh.
Power block. You know, you
yeah.
go wherever you wanted to. Hmm. I ended up at
North
the
Reading used to have an
time.
A day, B day. With a power block in the middle of the day.
I like
because when I used to work do a little work on the side for Mass Insight Education, when they were looking for schools that were doing really well on MCAS, and they were trying to capture, you know, sort of, okay, what is it that they're doing, and then push it out, you know, to other districts, I went to North Reading. And that's what they had. What Peter likes about this one is it's the first time he's seen a power block in a traditional schedule
mm-hmm.
as opposed to an A day, B day long block.
Right.
You know, so that's what intrigued him.
It was also interesting because it backed up to their long block.
Right.
Or it was before, I forget which side of their long block it was. But he said in a lot of cases teachers can also sort of use it how they want to. So if the AP history class is doing something they need extra time, they can actually hold those students back. So it just adds
more
a lot
flexibility.
Of flexibility to, you know, it's not just the bell rang and we need to go.
And it doesn't
right.
make everybody stay after school, because
right.
I'm sure that's part of the challenge,
for
right,
sure.
is getting kids to be able to get extra help. And plus, you know what, a lot of these kids, when they get to high school, they're going to go on to college, and, you know, they get, you know, they have to learn how to
yeah,
manage their time.
Schedule.
Right?
Right,
they
it's
to,
not
right,
going to be a set schedule
right.
of 7:30 to
right.
2.
Yeah,
that's,
yeah.
You're
sleeping at noon.
Instructional time. Instructional time is precious, though. I mean,
yeah, well, they're not giving up instructional time.
Okay.
Well, Peter's
and
always
they,
been adamant
he would not
about
intrigue
that.
He would not entertain it.
I mean, you only have
they,
so much
they
do
time.
Time
no, but what
but
they do is they did six longer periods instead of seven.
Yeah.
So they had a seven-day rotate. They had a seven periods, but they didn't all meet every day. So he explained that they meet in six little bit longer periods,
yeah.
but they have 35 minutes is this power block.
Yeah.
But their classes are 70 minutes. Some of the classes
some
are 70
of them,
minutes.
Right. So
long.
So they meet yeah. six, it's six periods a day that the kids are actually
that sounds right.
yeah.
engaged in action. But then right. they have this other opportunity. But they still have the seven classes.
Seven periods. Yeah. Yeah.
Did they have a longer day? A slightly longer day?
I don't think no. so. I don't think so.
They work magic.
But believe me, Peter won't come to you talking about changing
no,
the schedule.
No, and on Wednesday,
they
get out at one.
Get out at one.
Peter has a picture
every
of the
Wednesday.
Schedule. So
Peter has a picture of the schedule.
But it must add up so that the teachers
PD
get course. The amount of PD hours that they need.
That's yeah. when they do their PD.
Yeah. You know, because it's probably
no
they're probably only getting an hour or an hour and a
yeah,
half
hour,
of
yeah.
PD.
And they've been doing
and
that
that's probably
for
adding
years.
Up to
yeah.
the amount you need.
He did it when he was in elementary
yeah.
school.
And it's still a full day for the kids.
Yeah. Well, it's, I mean, from a PD perspective, I feel like I would prefer an hour a week instead of kind of the full day. You know, November 8th, we're going
to
be here for 8 hours. And
right.
Yeah, it depends on what you're doing.
Just,
now.
Yeah, if you're doing a value add, you can.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, if it's time for you to kind of get together with your grade level and plan your their next,
right.
you know, unit, then that makes sense. But if it's you're getting immersed in guided reading and you really need to be practicing it, so it really does depend on what you're doing.
Does,
but I'm glad it was a good visit.
So it's the whole district gets out early?
Yes. Yeah.
So elementary?
I guess.
Yeah.
I know the high school.
That's the way it used to be for when I was in Greenfield for a while. Every Wednesday afternoon when I was a teacher. Every Wednesday afternoon. Yeah.
Yeah, I wonder if, like, when people say about, like, starting school later, that half hour,
yeah.
I'm like, well,
yeah.
if you move to Hamilton, Wenham,
yeah.
do you ever think to ask, like, so you haven't, you get out early any days?
Yeah. I know, it's
you know?
So funny.
You don't think
so.
That is.
You don't think so.
That is a big
deal. It's a big thing.
Deal.
Yeah, it is a big deal. It's a lot of PD time.
Yeah.
But,
okay. Well, thanks for giving
yeah,
us that update.
Sure.
I appreciate that. So I think we are...
Done.
Good. We went through the agenda. There is no need for an executive session this evening, so I would like to make a motion to adjourn the meeting at 9:23 p.m.
So moved.
Second.
Great. All in favor?
Aye.
Have a good night.